Good morning, everybody. So welcome to Web3D. And this is session 6. We have 4 presentations. The first one is Gai Meng from Peking University, China. And his topic is Indo-3D WebGL Basic Open Source Framework for 3D Indo Map Visualizations. So let's welcome Dr. Gai Meng to give up his presentations. Yeah, thank you. Gai Meng, please.
Thank you for your introduction. And good to see all of you here, since we had such a good party last night. My name is Meng Gai. My supervisor is Professor Guo Qingwang. I'm from Peking University. My topic is Indoor 3D, a WebGL-based open-source framework for 3D indoor maps visualization. And you can see the example picture here. Here is my outline. First, I will introduce our motivation and the background. Next, I will introduce our design, including the data structure and architecture. And next is the algorithm. There are mainly 2 algorithms here. The first one is best view generation, and the second one is progressive visibility of elements. And the following is the results and future work. Of course, conclusion. First, let's see the motivation. Indoor maps are widely used in shopping malls, airports, subways, etc. Here are some examples.
I'm sorry,
just a
sec.
They give a brief view of the whole building, which can give the customers the convenience. But as far as we know, there has been no open source indoor map visualization framework. Although there are some commercial companies which provide the indoor map services, for example, the Google indoor map, and AMAP is a Chinese electronic map, which is similar to Google Map, and its Chinese name is Gaode. And WeDiTu is another company in China, which provides indoor map data services. Since related work is the reconstruction from 2D floor plans. Give a 2D floor plans as input, and this algorithm can reconstruct the whole building. But you can see there are many details, including the doors, the windows. But in our visualization program, we don't need these details. We just remove them. So this is a different program. We are focusing on the visualization, not the reconstruction. From the aspect of the data structure, there is an existing indoor map data structure, which is indoor GML. It's a candidate standard for an open source for an open data model, and it uses XML schema. But we all know that XML is complex and large, so in our solution, we use a JSON-based data structure. Here is the features of our design. First, it's web-based, which means we use WebGL or HTML canvas. And the data format is simple. It's good for network transmission. The framework is also easy to use and be customized by developers. First, let we check what do we need for the data structure. Of course, the very outline of this map is the shape of a building. And of course, we have several floors. In each floor, we have rooms, which are our polygons. Here, we also have some points, some public facility spots, which shows the entries, the elevators, escalators, etc. And we design our data structure straightforwardly related to the real thing. So here is the whole map data, and a part of it is the building's information. Also, we have an array of floors, and each floor has rooms and points. These points are the facility spots. Here is a sample of the JSON file. Now we can see a part of the building's information, which includes the shape. It's an array of points. Each pair of two points present a 2D point. So we only store the 2D points in our data, and we will generate the 3D mesh runtime. You can see there are more properties here, and the floors is an array. Also, the floor has its shape, and the rooms and the points. So the original JSON file is very small. In our cases, the file usually less than 1 million bytes. We can use more compression methods to make the file even less smaller. For example, the zip compression or the binary version of JSON, which is called BSON. So here is the architecture. We designed our architecture following the MVC rules. So the model is the building's data, and the renderer is the WebGL or canvas renderer. The canvas renderer is for backup compatibility. Controller is used to handle the user interactions. This diagram shows the whole architecture, and the core part is in the rectangle. The red rectangle shows the MVC three components, and the yellow ones are some utilities. This one is the input and output loader, and this is a theme to customize the style of this building. Now let's see how to use our framework. You just need two lines of code to create a default indoor map. First, you create an instance, and then you load the data. You can also customize it in a callback function. This shows a more complex example. You can see here, you we can set the, if the user, whether the user can select the rooms, and if you want to show the name of the rooms, and every step is done by a dot to form a chain, which is similar to the jQuery and other frameworks. Here comes the algorithm. The first one is the best view generation. Selecting the best view for a 3D object has been well studied, especially in the CAD field. But the problem here is more simple, because at least we don't have to find the upside, because it is naturally in the floor. But we are inspired by their idea, which is we want to maximize the visibility of visual features. So the visual features here are the rooms in the building. So how do we find the best view to get more rooms in a view? And now we design our method. First, we use principal component analysis to find the main direction. So now we know our camera direction should be orthogonal to this main direction. And then we compute the center of the floor's boundary. And this red point PY shows the center of the whole floor. And then we compute the average center of the rooms in this floor. And this blue point P2 demonstrates the center at the average center. Now we compare P1 and P2. We can know which side should we put the camera. And this is only the result of one floor. So we count the result of all floors to get the final result. The tilt angle theta, we set it to 75, which is usually used in many 3D indoor maps. And the length of the camera is a factor multiplied by the bounding box of this floor. And now we have the best view. The next problem is progressive visibility of elements. We know there are many elements in a floor, the names and the icons. We can't show them at the same time, or it will be a totally disaster. We can't see anything clearly. So we should show them progressively, which means when the user zooms in, we should more detailed, and when the user zoom out, we hide some. This is done by a priority-based method. The priority has two terms. The first term is the area of a room. So, which means if the room is larger, we want to show its names first. And the popularity, so if a brand of a room is more popular, we tend to show its name. And the final priority is the sum of these two terms. Is that enough? No. Because if we switch the visibility and the invisibility frequently, there will be a flicking effect. So we add a margin threshold here. We only when the two overlaps has a large larger distance than a margin, then we change its visibility. So this can avoid the flicking effect. Here I show some results. We use 3DS for WebGL rendering and use the native HTML5 canvas for 2D backward compatibility. The left one is the 3D version, and the right one is the 2D version. And here I show some customized themes. You can see we can change the change it to solid style or transparent style. We can also customize the interaction since we have API to get the object. We can highlight a floor or highlight a selected room. This is the first step of our work. Our future work has a lot of things to do. First, for an indoor map framework, it should have the ability to do the location registration and the navigation function. And more, we know the map data is important. So how do we acquire the map data? By now we have only two ways. The first way is to convert the existing data to our format. And we also build a utility to generate the 2D map manually. So the user just by clicking some point and it build an indoor map. So I want to show some demo. Here is the 3D version. You can see the elements hide and show progressively. And you can interact with it. Also, there are APIs to control the map. And then you can show all the building here, which looks pretty cool. Here is the 2D version. They use the same data, but just rendering in different ways. And I also create an interesting example just now. Let's see. So here is the conclusion. In this paper, we presented our indoor 3D framework. It takes advantage of WebGL to render 3D indoor maps. We designed a JSON file to store the map structure, and we solved several problems, such as best view selection and progressive element visibility to achieve better user experience. The framework is designed flexible, so it allows the developers to customize it conveniently. And thank you. This is the GitHub link of this framework, and this is my email address. If you want to contact me or ask for the photos I took yesterday, please send a mail to me. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Gaiman. Very excited work. So I think you will have many questions. So just ask. Do you have any questions?
Yes, I agree with our chair. Wonderful work. Thank you.
Thank you.
On the first day, Thursday, There were some presentations that says we are working on an X3D JSON encoding.
Yes, yes.
For these kinds of activities. And also some comparisons of compressed JSON to efficient XML, XML compression of X3D.
Yes, yes.
So I think those results are complementary. So we'll be very interested to if you can look at that.
Yes, yes, I noticed that. Thank you. For example, the SRC method and the EXI compression method. They are very good. I will consider those formats. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, please.
I'm curious about. I think there's some effort and some semantic work in indoor ML and some efforts inside the Open Geospatial Consortium to create a nice interoperable schema for indoor data. Have you looked at any of that and seen if there's any way to contribute or participate in that effort?
You mean the indoor GML?
Yeah, that's it, yes.
Yeah, yeah. It is mainly used for navigation. So it construct a graph of the scene. By now, we do not need that function. But in the future, I write it here, we will want to add some location registration and navigation function. So. I think I will consider the indoor method, the indoor GML.
Okay.
Also, thank you.
Okay. Any questions? So no questions. So I will ask. I think at least I have four questions to ask. firstly, for engineering purpose,
yes.
Your system should allow any building files formats can be imported to your system.
Yeah, yeah.
So I will ask you if AutoCAD file or BIM file can be imported to your system.
Yeah, I think it can be done, but it's also the future work. So as they said, we want to build a tool to acquire the map data, which including convert the existing CAD file or BIM
yes.
file to this. But it need more machine learning method to recognize which is a room and which is a floor. So,
yeah.
So it's not that easy. And maybe it will not be total automatically, maybe just a semi-automatic.
Yes,
automatic.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, exactly. So this is the first question. The next one is very related to your first one. Next one is, you will see, is very difficult to import AutoCAD file or BIM file to your system automatically.
Yeah.
I think semi-automatic can be accepted,
yes.
But your system should be permitted modify, move anything, something, and rotate something.
Yes.
So your system should allow a user to edit.
Yeah, by now we use another tool. Yeah, we use another tool to edit the map. So the visualization and the modify is separated.
Yeah.
I also considering combine them to one framework. Yeah.
Okay. This is editor. Editor.
Yeah.
So
there is another editor.
Yes. You have not finished it.
Yeah, not finished because it must handle the interaction.
Yes.
If you don't do it carefully, the software will crash.
Yes. So this problem I may help you to do that. So the third question is, the navigation for map is very important. So
yes.
How to generate a navigation parts automatically, that's very important function for 3D map.
Yes.
So did you consider this problem?
Yeah, I have considered two methods. Maybe you can provide me more methods. The first method I'm considering is the famous A-star.
A-star.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you don't need to know much about the structure of the thing. You just use the A-star to find a path.
Shortest path.
Yeah, shortest path.
Mm.
But maybe
not good parts.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
And maybe not the choice that the
yes.
customer will choose
because
yes. he don't know the whole building, so
yeah.
he may not be able to find a shortest path.
Mm-hmm.
And the second method is something related to the indoor GML, and we create the C node, maybe automatically or maybe. Labeled by user previously, so the navigation takes the advantage of the nodes in
mm-hmm.
of the scene structure.
So some computer vision people just working on ceilings, Guanzhoudu ceilings based navigation can produce very beautiful parts with a best view. So that's very useful for 3D map.
Yeah, yeah.
This is my another suggestions. And my last question is, so I take a look. So, yes. Do your system have a collision detection functions?
Yeah,
and how much scale the 3D map?
Sorry?
How much scale, how many buildings, how many layers at most?
Because in real life, we usually don't have a building have too many layers. It's limited.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So maybe a more of 10 layers is
10 layers.
Yeah. Is maps in the real life. If the building is taller, the customer would not go up there. So shopping malls are very short.
Okay.
Yeah, I haven't tested it yet.
Okay.
But I think a building with less than 20 layers and maybe about hundreds of or thousands polygons acceptable.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
My name is Ralf Kupke. I'm here to present the case study on 3D geospatial applications in the web using state-of-the-art WebGL frameworks. So basically, what we have done in our department is put here into the paper and into the presentations over the past 2 years. And what we want to share is our lessons learned and what we have experienced in the time. So about me, as I said, my name is Rolf Kutbel. I'm 30 years old, or young. And as you know, Johannes Baer and Mr. Fellner very well, I'm also from the same institution, the Fraunhofer IGD, but work in a different department, it's the Department of Geospatial Management. And personally, my main interest is are fancy visualizations. So basically, I want everything to look good. And so my personally, I started with the offline visualization frameworks like Instant Reality or Unity. And of course, with the demand of web visualizations, now we have to work with that WebGL, which introduces new challenges. And yeah, it's been, has given me over the past years a bit of a headache. So this is what I'm going to show you. And so what's the problem with geospatial data? And it is very heterogeneous. We have, as an upper systems, 3D geometries, which is no problem. And another thing in geospatial is that we have 2D geometries describing areas, points, or lines. And the other things is like we have very different kinds of imageries, like the acquired images from satellites, flyovers, but also abstract maps like OpenStreetMap, for example. And users want these informations to be exchangeable. Another huge thing is our point clouds currently. There are new systems introduced every year, generating more point clouds. They are getting denser and denser, the point clouds. And so we have also a challenge we had to face. And very important is also the metadata. People or the user want to see what, want to know what he's seeing in the visualization. And at best, have also understand the relations between the data. And not only the data is heterogeneous, but also the applications. So users want very high detailed small areas. They want to, for example, analyze a planning of a road, of a new road junction. Or they want to understand the overall changes in the landscape done by the planning of a wind park. So there are very different kinds of requirements here. And there's yet no framework which can handle all these challenges. So what I'm going to show you now is, in the paper I have 5 different use cases, but I can only show you 4 here. And we solved it with 3 different frameworks, Xfreedom, FreeJS in a combination with Poetry and Cesium. And what I'm going to show you is, at the beginning I wanted to show you a live demo, but since the internet connection is pretty bad, I took videos, which are a bit bumpy, so excuse this please, but I think you will get the idea. So the first use case is an EU project, which is already finished. It's called Urban API. It's a web application for public participation or for for urban planners which want to present their ideas. And I'm going to show you the video now. Which side is it? Oh, yeah, okay. Ooh, it's big. Okay, give me a second.
Yeah.
The thing is that duplication on the beamer doesn't work, so we have to extend it. So I have to fix it to the size of the beamer. Oh. No. Ah, so no. So what you see here is a bottle of API. In the middle you see visualization of Vienna. There were different cities visualized during the project, but Vienna is a pretty good example. And what you see here is that we can freely navigate through the scene. This is now done with Xfreedom. And we use our department-owned product, the city server, to transform the data to X3D from CityGML. Oh, sorry,
you keep going. Great.
So what you see here is like the portal which allows you to annotate different information to say, okay, it's all in German, sorry, but it says there's a building blocking the road, there's a huge tower in the middle, and they want to analyze the shadows. So what you can see here is that we can choose freely the date and the time of day, and so the sun position is correctly calculated, and so the shadows can be animated, and the user can get an idea of how the shadows will pass during the day here, and see, for example, how this big building in the middle here is affecting the other, the other buildings. And another option is that you can place different objects here and translate them, rotate them, scale them. You see here on the bottom, it's not a good real life example, but you can place a chapel here along the riverside. This first try didn't work, so this will be your next try. So you can place it here and then translate and rotate it. And this is some Xtreedom. The really good thing about Xtreedom here is that you can immediately, all the annotations, for example, are geolocated. They are out of the box storable. So it's something you get out of the box. And for example, which is also very nice and most other frameworks can't handle that well, is the shading and the lighting of a scene. So, close this video now, show you, hopefully this just starts now with what. Okay. There's another view of the Urban Epic Air Portal. So this is a view which allows, for example, to give the user an impression of planned architecture. Again, the same example here in the middle, the huge building. You have two different windows which you can navigate individually, which is pretty hard exactly, and this is why we have this this bookmarks on here. So you can click them so that both views rotate to the same position, and you can now exhibit or see how the new architecture fits into the landscape. You can see that's why I'm doing the video, even after 10 tries of loading the demo, some types were missing in the city, so this isn't usual that there's no ground in Vienna. It usually is. this is the first use case. Next use case is the visualization of the city model. It's a building in Schwenning, which is in the south of Germany. And we had to use a different framework now. We had to use another framework now, which allows us to. Which allows us to access the low-level WebGL API. Because the raw data of the city model itself is around 6 gigabytes, and there's also terrain and all the photos we actually use. So we had to use some implementation which allows us to handle the memory management, on the computer and on the graphics card. What we did here is implement an algorithm which is a very naive scheme of streaming. So basically around the camera there's the city model loaded. And as you can see here, when I turn the camera, only around the camera the city model is loaded so that we can, graphics card can handle all the information. And what's also pretty great about VJS here is that due to the fact that you can access the low-level API, it was pretty easy to do a bit of fancy visualization stuff. I think it's a little bit later in the video. We implemented a shader, which allowed us to, when we change the day of time, to have like an atmospheric effect when the sun's going down. Which made our customer pretty happy and astonishing. So now to the use case of handling point clouds.
Is that from PGIS?
Yeah, so this is PGIS. Sorry, the slide didn't change. It only changed here on my screen. Yeah, so yes, this was the one I just showed you, Filling Schwenning. And the next one I show you is a use case made in Wiesbaden. This is this came up from Urban Deep Planners, which wanted a good tool for public participation. and they wanted to show how the new road junction fits into the housing area. And the block is pretty small, so only about 3 to 1 kilometers. There's basically no problem displaying. The hardest point, or the challenge, was to include the point cloud, which is about 2.4 billion colored points, and was in a, as an LAS file or compressed LAZ file, was about 10 gigabytes. So we had to look around what tool is possible to handle all these data, and we came upon Poetry, which is a plugin made for Vue.js, and uses. So, should we do video also? Parallel. I'm clicking on the video, not on PowerPoint. Come on. You see the area is pretty small, and we have a normal city model which is untextured, and a terrain model with orthophotos, and now I put on the point cloud. And as you can see, when the camera moves through a scene, that as the camera changes, points close to the camera get loaded. So Poetry also offers you a tool to transform the data from the original LAZ format to an octree representation, so that it basically allows you to very smart and very fast loading of the data. And you can see here, when you get closer to the advertisement, that the resolution of the point cloud is so so big that you can easily see the advertisement here. So this is I think this is very nice for future geospatial visualizations, because point clouds give you very realistic view of the world, which is a problem which we face with only viewing city models which are untextured, connected with terrain model and also photos, and because it always looks very abstract. But here, with all this information of the trees and leaves and everything, it somehow just feels realistic. As you can see here, we can put on the planning, and the point cloud is cutted so that you have a free look at the planning and how it fits into the section. And yeah, so what we did is reference the whole planning with the geospatial data and fit it into the country, and also make these cuttings from the roads, or the holes between the road and the new planned road and the terrain, and there's kind of stuff to the holes, and the user is able to make visible individual elements, so that the urban planner, I don't know why they do it, but they want this feature to have an edit somehow, I guess. And the great thing is also that you can, on runtime, change the available points for visualization, so you can easily modify the view so it fits to the capability of your computer. So far, so this, in the last use case I want to show you is the one using Cesium, which is about the demand of customers that they want to see big landscapes, and they want a tool which is basically like Google Earth. And there were many frameworks which tried this, another Worldwind, but Cesium took it to another level. So they're really into the implementing. They have really good tutorial. They have a nice sandcastle demo to test your implementations. And what's really great about Cesium, and I'll show you this in the video, is that it offers you out of the box tools like streaming of terrain. You can, during runtime, interchange information of the terrain, of the imagery. and so you see here, this is a big area in the middle of Germany, and what you see here is our own data, which we got from the official institution of this area. So what they offer is in a resolution of the terrain of 1 meter, and the imagery is about 20 centimeters each pixel. And yeah, so by using different tools, you can transform your original data, which can be in a GeoTIFF or an XY set, to an octree representation, so that it can be loaded by Cesium. And what you just have seen is like I just exchanged information of the terrain from a terrain model, which is without information of buildings or woods, to the surface model, which includes this information. As you see here, you can now see the height information of the buildings and of the woods. And what we also do is like combine these informations. So basically, around the city, we use different informations. For example, the official city model. And in this area, we only use the terrain model, so that there is no intersection between those two informations. But on the outer rims, where you see in the woods, should be loaded somehow soon, you see that the information about the height of the woods is still there. So this is basically what we are doing. And so what we extend the functionality of Cesium. It offers you already a lot of typical geospatial functionalities. But for example, now we have these bright red dots, which are kind of like camera spots. You can just click on them, and the camera changes immediately to give the user a good impression of the landscape. This, for example, is the use case where a provider of wind parks wants to maintain the wind park and have visualization out of this. And yeah, basically this can be it's possible for an arbitrary big sized area. Another nice thing is Cesium supports the loading of JSON and GeoJSON, so you can put information into the GeoJSON is already shown in the box you just saw on the upper right corner. I just think you see it again. What I just showed you was a measurement and landscape, and now I just created a new camera spot by two clicks, so that the user can just say, hey, I want to see now from point A and look in direction of point B. And here's what I've mentioned with the metadata, which is also part of a out-of-box function Cesium offers the implementer, which is pretty nice. So far for the use cases. So we really didn't, or I want to say it's like in the first round of the paper, the title was not using WebGL frameworks, but comparing WebGL frameworks. But the point is, we realized there is a real possibility to compare them, because, as I said, the use cases we had, they were comparable, because the other frameworks couldn't handle the functionalities the other frameworks could. So what we can only offer you is like give you our lessons learned and tell you and give you an idea why we choose the frameworks for which kind of requirement. The basic conclusion is like there is no framework which can handle all the needs of the geospatial community and handle all the data. So you have to make analysis of the task at hand. And what we like about Xtreme is like this declarative. It's very good for rapid prototyping. You have information, you can store them immediately, and we have a very nice renderer with Xfreedom. Vue.js offers you a lot of potential, because you can access the low-level API of WebGL, and it's fast and flexible, but it's a lot more work. So you have to be, you have to work yourself into WebGL to access all the possibilities. Cesium, it's like the new Google Earth. Google Office at Benton, maybe you know. So, and the company behind Cesium, yeah, kind of says under their hands that they want to be the new Google Earth and, yeah, get the community to work with their tool. And yeah, it's really great, and there are a lot of functionalities, as I said, which can be used and are standard functionalities for geospatial. So I hoped that was a nice use case for you to see. Thank you for your attention, and yeah, I'm open for questions.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for perfect introduction of yourself. And I really agree with you, Web3D gave us a lot of high-tech power. We met a lot of bottleneck power, but I really felt thanksgiving because that headache or bottleneck power wake up our soul and push us to solve such bottleneck power. So thanks for your excellent work. That exploration is very essential. So any questions?
Hi. I guess in the, in the first video where you were showing City G,
of Vienna, the Urban API.
Yeah, and it looked to me like the graphics was being streamed down, and you were still manipulating it. Was that correct?
No, this isn't correct. Okay. So basically, this was a problem why it took me so long to make the video. All the information has to be loaded upfront.
Okay.
So yeah, the model has to be loaded, and then you can manipulate. And you can manipulate it already when it's loading, but it doesn't really make sense. So there's no streaming really like Cesium, for example, terrain.
Okay. Cesium streams?
Yeah, the terrain. Yeah.
Cool. Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks, a very nice overview of the state-of-the-art technologies. And my question is, in many cases, in geospatial application, we have also to consider the a lot of work that we have to prepare the information and adjust the information for visualization.
Mm-hmm.
Have you considered in your study also these aspects? How far are the different solutions that you have evaluated in order to manage the raw data coming from geospatial and to be ready for the deploy on the application?
Well, yeah, basically for deploying information from the raw data to the visualization, we have our own tooling department. We have the CityServer 3D. Which basically loads all the standard geospatial information. And what we did in the last year is also to build a pipeline, or a toolbox we say, to very easily transform the data, like also create an octree, for example, for cesium, or change the resolutions of the textures or of the terrain to fit other frameworks. So basically what we do is like, have our own solution to do this. I don't know if this was the question, but the answer to your question.
So you use the same, your solution for all the free.
Yeah, so we also use open source software. So for example, for Cesium, there is this Cesium Terrain Builder and server. And yeah, we kind of learn the lessons they made. And it's a good thing about open source, and yeah, so. We, of course, use information which is already open source, basically.
Thanks. Any other questions? Okay.
A very nice comparison. Since you're serving most of the data from a server, you have complete control of the coordinate system, and you can adjust a local coordinate system for the X-ray DOM view. Now that most of the geospatial component has been implemented in X3 DOM supporting a few spatial reference systems, would your conclusions change at all and your assessment change?
Well, that's the problem. One thing, I was an implementer, a colleague of mine did this, and the project already finished like half a year ago and was ongoing for like 3 years. And at the time of the implementation, as far as I know, so I might be wrong, I think the geo component of X3 wasn't too well implemented.
Okay.
I think it's something you did in the last year.
It's been the last 6 months, yeah.
Last 6 months, basically, yeah. So at the time of implementation, there wasn't the proper implementation of the geo components. So, yeah, sorry, I can't really tell you something about that.
Okay, exactly.
Oh, I just a quick question. You may have mentioned, but I was not here from the beginning. Who provides the data? Raw data?
Yeah, our customers. For example, the U project, Vienna was part of the U project. The second example, which was Berlin, this is a city, and they have their own data and they come to us and say, hey, we want a web visualization. So they turn it over to us. And the same for Wiesbaden, the third example of the point cloud, they also is data of the city. And the third example, this was the official data of Bundesland Hessen. So we have different counties in Germany, and every, I don't know if county is the right word, but
states,
yeah. So every state has their own institution which handles the acquires and stores and offers the geo data, and we have a strong connection with this institution. So basically, there's always some co-work. So basically, we get the data from them.
And the data is public available or not?
No, it's not public available. So the paper is.
Yeah, it comes in a similar format, but for different states, you got the same format, or you have to.
Mostly the same format. So we have,
same field names. Or
yeah. Basically, we have, they offer you most of the time for the terrain X, Y, Z for the terrain, CTGML for the buildings, and TIFF for the imagery. And this example for the state of Hessen is the way, and for Bayern and for Baden-Württemberg. But it didn't really work with the other states, so that might be different formats there.
I think it is available, but it's not for free.
Yeah, it's available, but not for free.
The question was, is it publicly available? Yes, it is, but it's not for free.
Yeah, you have to pay for this, yeah.
Yes.
Okay,
last question.
Thanks for the nice comparison. You said in X3 DOM it was impossible to access the WebGL functionality. So is it impossible or is it just hard? So is there a way to
As I said, I was an implementer. I just know we thought about also using X3DOM for the visualization of the city model, and we talked to Johannes and Max, and to access, for example, to control the memory management. And at the time, I think it was not so easy.
It's in general not easy. So inside a browser, each browser might behave differently. So some browsers, for example, if you allocate say more than 1.1 gigabyte, Internet Explorer will just crash or refuse to render anything. And Chrome will maybe continue, but not push anything to the GPU. So your model is not complete and you can still render it. And Firefox will do the job. So what do you do? And then I was really wondering, so maybe that's a question now from my side to Wald.
Yeah.
How you manage that with 3JS, because you said, we are doing some memory management here.
Mm-hmm.
So I can see that you can just load the data that is near the viewpoint.
Mm-hmm.
But do you have any handling like for replacement of chunks in memory, or you just rely on that everything works fine if you push new data to the GPU and the old gets evicted from memory?
So, as I've submitted, Michel Kramer, which you know, implemented this, but as far as I know, so you don't really know about how many memories available at the graphics card.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. You never
API.
Can find out.
So what, for example, Cesium also does is like they're really defensive about this algorithm, so they they say like we only acquire like about 100 megabytes. So it's just the way of, yeah, hopefully saying, okay, this might fit in every graphics card available. And yeah, I can't really tell you which kind of WebGL functions Michel used to free the memory and the JavaScript object, but yeah, you have a good way to ask him, but yeah, yes. I don't know, I can't give you the whole audience his note.
Yeah, but it's already interesting.
Yes.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, any other questions? If no questions, let's go to the next presentation. I know you have a lot of questions, and me too. So I suggest that maybe a special workshop should be organized to discuss, to do research or development in this very challenging problem. Okay, thanks. Okay, next topic is fast decomposition for web basic view dependent 3D rendering. So very interesting and very important topic. So please.
Okay. My question is about how to efficiently render meshes potentially big on browsers and in rendering and transmitting the mesh to the user for the best user experience. To do so, in this paper we are not concerned with the interface. To do so, our rendering algorithm must be progressive, so start rendering data as soon as data arrives and improve the quality of the model. It must be adaptive, so must be able to render to adapt the resolution of the model to the viewpoint, so to make best use of the available data, and must be able to optimize the bandwidth usage, which is limited, and so compression here is another point. The overall rendering algorithm is a multi-resolution algorithm called batch multi-triangulation. This is from 10 years ago, about in not only web setting, in native applications. And basically, the idea is to scale the primitive of the multi-resolution so that instead of working on the level of the triangles, we work with thousands of triangles. So the model is subdivided in a set of patches. You can see each patch is about the same size, a few thousand triangles, and there are patches at different resolution. And there is this is done in such a way that it's possible to reassemble the patches to make a seamless model, which has a varying resolution in part of the model. You see on the left part near the viewpoint, there are a lot of small patches, so a lot of triangles, and far away where the patches are larger, so that the projected screen size of the triangles is more or less constant. This optimizes the usage of the triangle badge, and this is really important for large meshes. We have no time to go into detail about these algorithms, which are well published. If you want, you can find the detail in my PhD thesis. The advantage of this multi-resolution algorithm respect to other algorithms is that it requires very low CPU, because the decision tree for each is very small, because each node of the decision tree, whether I draw a patch or refine it, is on the level of thousands of triangles. Is easily out of core because each patch is independent from the other, and it's just geometry, so won't mess with shaders and other stuff that may be limited in WebGL or interfere with the shaders of the user. So the disadvantage, of course, is that being a multi-resolution algorithm, the size is double what of the normal models. The granularity is reduced because our primitive is thousands of triangles, so for very small model, this won't work very well. It will be just the level of the tail or something. So for very small model, this is not very useful. Very small, I mean, 1,000 triangles or so. And the management of the border between patches, which are replicated, is a bit complicated during construction. Okay, before going to data layout, how do I get out of here? I want to show a quick demo, and I feel bold, so I will use the network and hope for the best. Okay. So this is, let's say, this is a model which has about 28 million triangles. No, sorry, it's 9 million triangles, this one. And as you can see, the model will get refined when we zoom in some part. If you want to see what's really happened, I can show you. With some magic tricks. Okay, no, sorry. Debug. No. Maybe this. Maybe this. Sorry. Okay. Also, sorry for the. You see the model is subdivided in patches, and patches are replaced while we move around, so to optimize the triangles, and new patches are loaded while we zoom in. Okay, here the final, we are close to the final resolution. Okay. While if you use this coloring, it looks like popping stuff. But if the as you saw, that effect is not very noticeable because the difference in screen size in screen of the triangle is very small. So okay. So this is about the look back. Okay, so it's continuously updating. Let's go back. What is the data layout of this system? It's very simple. It's just a header with basic information, an index which keep track of the different patches. So we have the number of vertices, the number of triangles, where the patch is located in the file, and the information needed for the multi-resolution visualization, so the error, geometric error associated to the patch, and the bounding sphere. And the data is loaded in WebGL using HTTP range requests, so we don't have multiple files, we just have one file to deal with. And pipelining ensures that loading the file, pipelining is not the optimization of the browser, so that it concatenates different requests. So this is as fast as loading the file in one go. How do we do the rendering? The rendering is just a matter of assembling the correct patches. So we have a tree, we traverse the tree, and we take into account which patches we already loaded from the network, the triangle budget, how many triangles we want to render, and the error, so to prioritize certain patches versus others. There is one draw call for each patch, so this is very fast and very GPU friendly, because each draw calls draw a lot of triangles, nice, potentially up to 64,000. And while we render, we do also the prefetching and the optimization of the frame per second, adjusting to the capability of the browser. Of course, what we want to add, what we added in this paper is mesh compression, because the system leads well to mesh compression, because if we just compress each patch independently, we can use basically any compression algorithm. Each patch is a small mesh per se. We only have to ensure that the boundary of the patches matches, because when you quantize vertex, you need to quantize at the same time, in the same manner, in different patches, not to see cracks. Of course, we developed a new algorithm for compression, because we weren't really satisfied with the existing algorithm. So when developing a mesh compression algorithm, there are a lot of different choices to make. Whether I want topological compression or not, whether I want global or local parameterization, which encoder. And each one affects the most important aspect, which is the compression ratio versus the decompression speed. The more to improve compression ratio, like small files, I need to make a lot of work, transformation, computation, and this affects the compression speed. The problem is that if I'm doing too much work, it will take much more time to decompress the data than to download it, and so it will not work. Here is an example in benchmark made by Limpel in a paper last year, I think, or 2 years ago, where it compared the same model, which is about 200,000 triangles on a moderately slow network, and how this is the compression time versus the download time on a PC, which has a high computational power, and an iPad, where the low computational time, so that the compression will be longer. And you can see that the result changes a lot. Arguments that are fast in one side can be very slow on the other. For example, if you look at this one, CTM, OpenCTM, you see that in iPad, the decompression time is extremely long, while in the PC is much more comparable to the download time. Here we can also have a glimpse of what choices are important. For example, OpenCTM make use of LZMA as an entropy compressor, and you can see what happens when it was replaced with ZIP, Lamperman-Zimmermann algorithm. So this is the difference in the compression time, which is huge. And you can see here instead the difference in the compression rate, which is quite small. So this is a choice worth making, replacing to a more performant in terms of speed the compression if you lose some compression ratio. And here I added my results using the OpenCTM for comparison, because of course I have not access to the PC and maybe the iPad 3, but certainly not the PC they used. And this, here you can see the difference in terms of compression ratio that using topological and parallelogram prediction for the vertex, which is the main difference between us and the CTM implementation in terms of pure algorithm. So what is topological compression is taking advantage of the fact that the meshes are not just a bunch of triangles, but they are connected. So it is often not used in mesh compression when one aims for speed, because it's a bit complex, and so people just prefer to connect to encode the connectivity using differences or other simpler methods. But it's very powerful because it reduced it improved the compression ratios quite a lot. So we use a modified version of the edge bracket, which is an old algorithm from mesh compression. And the idea basically is that we start with one triangle, this one. We have three edges, and we start from one edge and add another triangle, then add another triangle, then another one, then another one. And here we are closing the fan. So we have a different operation. We are not adding a triangle with a new vertex. We are closing, so we use a different operation. So the idea is that we can turn a triangulation into a sequence of symbols with different operation and replay this operation to reconstruct the original mesh. To do so, we need to keep track of the boundary of the decoder region, which is a connected list of oriented edges, and to define a few operations. The operations are adding a new vertex, adding and a new triangle, adding a triangle on an existing vertex. This is a split operation, you see later why, and it's the most complex operation. Closing left or right, which is closing a fan either clockwise or counterclockwise, and adding an external border where the mesh has not a triangle on that side. We also have an additional operation with respect to edge bracket, which is the internal boundary. This is due to the way we manage the split. So the split happens when the boundary meets itself. And basically, we have to reference an existing vertex. But more importantly, we have to split, it's called this way, because we have to split the ring of the boundary. Here, it should become two rings here, one inside, the small one, and the other one outside. And this is the most complicated operation because it needs topological information. You need to update the relation between vertices, edges, and faces, and this is quite costly. So we decide what happens if we don't split into two rings. Well, it happens that when you keep going like this, here we have a split, and here we have another triangle, we have no knowledge that these two edges are adjacent. And since we do not know, we have to add additional symbol to mark them as adjacent, which are, these are boundary symbols, S. And of course, this is not optimal in terms of compression ratio. The trick is that by changing the order on which we process the edges here, we can make this operation quite rare. And so it will not impact very much the compression ratio, and we avoid all the complexity of the topology, the topological structure. The other choice we made is global quantization, because we need the patch position, the vertex position, to be consistent when they are aggregated in different patches, so we cannot have a local quantization, which would be more efficient a little bit. The compression ratio quite a lot, and it's not very costly, it's just a firebox of sorts. And this is very important from meshes, which are output of subdivision surfaces or stuff like this, where triangulation is very regular. How do we encode these differences? Well, the idea is very simple. We write the difference in binary numbers. We store on a string the number of bits, like this, 4, 3, 2. And on a bit stream, we store the remainder bits. The first one is always 1, so it's not really needed. The idea is that doing this way, we have a very small dictionary, because the dictionary is basically the logarithm of the differences. And as we will see later, the size of the dictionary impacts the speeds a lot. So this way we have a very small dictionary, and we have just to read from a bit stream the rest of the bits. What algorithm to choose for entropy compression? We have a few choices, a dictionary based, like Lempen and Zipmer or stuff like this. The problem with this algorithm is that while they are very fast, because the whole size grows, so each new token is a lot of symbols, the dictionary updates are costly, so this is potentially a drawback. Arithmetic encoding would be nice for the, because it has the best compression ratio, but the problem is that there is a lot of bit manipulation, and in JavaScript this is bad. We have Huffman. Pajarola made an optimization so that it turns out that it's basically a table lookup. The problem with this is that the table lookup is very expensive. So the initialization of the data of the structure before you start the coding is expensive. And we have small streams. So this is good, but not good enough. And we choose Tunstall, which is basically the reverse of Huffman. Tunstall turns an variable number of symbols into a fixed number of bits. So it turns, for example, suppose we have a word of 1 byte, different group of symbols are turned in 1 byte during compression. The nice thing is that the reverse is that we just read 1 byte and output a few symbols. So the decompression is just a table lookup. You can't be faster than this. It's basically impossible. And also, this is also can be parallelizable and moved to the GPU. So for later stuff, this decompression stage could be moved to the GPU, because this kind of compression algorithm can be parallelized, unless all the other. What difference does it make here? I made some speed test using available implementation of a few algorithms. We didn't use the, I don't include the range encoding, because it was really too slow, the arithmetic encoding. So here the difference between Tunstall and Huffman is mainly due to the fact that there is this initialization table, which as soon as the symbol increase becomes very, very heavy, and you see how the difference keep growing with the number of symbols. And the same problem with the dictionary is for the LZMA algorithm, where with few symbols this is as fast, but as soon as you increase the symbol, the speed drops dramatically. What happens when we move to GPU? Tunstall and Huffman have the same ratio, because the algorithm is basically the same, the compression algorithm. What happens is that the implementation of LZMA is really bad. It's like 10 times slower. 10 times is a lot. That is the reason why OpenCDM is slowing in the coding, basically. There are faster implementation of different and similar algorithms, but none as fast as Tunstall. What we pay for having this speed update is 10% in the compression, which, due to our encoding, affects only the number of the symbol and not the bit stream. So in reality, it's much less for us. It's 10% on one part of the encoded data. Okay, this is in million of triangles per second, million of symbols per second. So this speed, even in JavaScript, is 200 million symbols per second, which is quite enough. In terms of the convection compression speed, we reach about 1-3 million triangles per second in JavaScript, which is quite good in a single thread. In Chrome, this is difficult to measure for a lot of reasons, and 16 million triangles per second in C++. And this is good, the normals and color curve benefits. The source code and the executables are available, not really right now, let's say next month, because we have the in these two libraries. The Nexus library is the library that deals with the compression and multi-resolution visualization, and there is a wrapper library, 3D-Hop, where you have also the interface, the JavaScript interface with icons, and where you can set up track walls and other stuff. And soon we will add other data. Okay, just for comparison, I show you what happens when we go to other, when we use the other system. OpenCPM is not progressive, and this is when what happens with the other sized model. Okay. This is going to work. WebGL loader is fast enough and compressed well enough, maybe, but the problem is that also it's not progressive, so you have to wait. Yes, I'm finished. Pop buffers has the advantage of being progressive. The problem is that the size is quite big, so it takes a while to get to a final resolution. And this, for comparison, is our method.
Limit, just one question.
Hi. Nice demo. I have a couple of questions, maybe I'll ask you later, but I want to know what the, you talked about your modified edge breaker you're using for the, as a pre-processing step. You didn't tell us like how much time do you take, like how do you process the model?
It's in the paper, but to process the model takes very little because the compression is 1 million triangles per second.
Yeah, so like compared to decompression, how much time does it take? Compared to decompression on the client side, how much time does the compression or the pre-processing step take?
I don't understand it.
Okay, I'll ask you later.
Yeah. Sorry.
So for the time limit, we can take a discussion after this session. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks again. Last speaker is Jian Sutter.
Yes.
Okay. So CSS integration for Declarative 3D. So Sutter, please.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for the introduction. I'm going to present our latest work on CSS integration for Declarative 3D. And I want to start right up with the motivation. And I want to do that by example. So, consider a typical, in our case, XML 3D scene. We've got camera, light source, default scene model, two meshes, one hidden, one visible, and two materials that additionally share materials, material data, and the non-hover listener that should exchange the material as soon as the mouse hovers the object. And this will result in somehow like this. So lots of markup, pretty hard to understand. And to see what's style related, I highlighted everything that we consider style for the declarative 3D. And I would like to reduce that. And this is why we started to do the CSS integration. What's other reasons for the CSS integration is the final technology that we need for Declarative 3D to fully comprise the web stack. We have the JavaScript, we have the DOM integration, and now follows the CSS integration. CSS is to decouple style from the structure. So we can now use that for decorative 3D. It enables new debugging facilities that we have in the browsers, like the rules view and the style editor. We will see that later on in the video. And it reduces application logic, because typically we use a lot of Clue code to use on hover listeners, on click listeners, to implement typical things like highlighting objects. This is where CSS comes right out of the box with its pseudo classes like on hover, active, and so on. And we can use them for decorative 3D as well. So, what we consider style currently is visibility, material parameters, light configuration, and camera intrinsic values. And this is actually also the outline for the reminder of the talk, so we go one by one. And we start with visibility, which in CSS is definable by two properties. There is visibility and there is display. Visibility has two values, which is hidden and visible. Display has none. And display block, inline, and lots of other things, but important is the display none. The difference between the two is that a visibility hidden element still contributes to the overall flow of the website. So if you hide an element with visibility hidden, it would still have a size, a bounding box, and elements will flow around it. If you use display none, it gets virtually a size of zero, so it collapses. This makes it actually to have three states in CSS for visibility, because we can have visibility visible, hidden, and display none. So problem is, in graphics, we typically have only two states. We have hidden and visible. So question is, how do we use that for 3D graphics? Our approach is to simply make 3D graphics objects having tri-state visibility. We use visible, which is the default. It's interactive. You render it, you see it in the scene. But additionally, we consider transparent, which we mean is it's not rendered, it's completely transparent. It's like setting the alpha value in your shader to zero. But it will still be interactive. This is important for example use cases like cultural heritage, where you have large laser scans and a single mesh, and you want to make it interactive. You use some planes that are actually invisible or wrap around cylinders that are clickable. And this is exactly what this value should be. So it's transparent, it doesn't contribute to the rendering, to the fine color, but it's still clickable using on-click handler, on-hover handler, and so on. And still we have the hidden, which makes it completely non-interactive, like we do it right now if we say visible false. Therefore we use the properties visibility hidden to achieve the transparent but still interactive thing. We use the display none to completely hide the element and make it non-interactive. This is important to use the display none also because this is what, for example, jQuery uses to hide the element. If you say jQuery.hide, the element will get a style display none. So to be compatible with this, we've chosen to use display none for this. And of course, any value except hidden doesn't make much sense for a 3D graphic, so it's just to be visible again. Next up is the material thing. There are two types to handle this in real time. And we discussed it yesterday in our ShadeShares tutorial. There's actually the Uber shader or snippet compositor approach, where you have a large shader that has lots of materials, and you start to strip out snippets using a C-style preprocessor and defines, or you combine snippets depending on the materials that are there. So, in fact, you should just have a fixed set of materials with a fixed set of parameters. So, building this into CSS would be easy. Just define all the parameters you have as CSS properties, just define their types, and you're done. But as soon as you start to use custom shaders, there is no fixed set. It's all user-defined. User can define types, user can define names, and there is no way to actually use predefined properties in CSS. So, question is, how can we use CSS together with custom materials? Our solution is based on the CSS custom properties specification, which simply allows arbitrary custom parameters to be used in your CSS rules. They just have to start with double hidden, like in the second line here, an example property. Their initial use case is actually to be able to create variables in your style sheets that can be used later on to define font size and default colors, but we use them to define our own properties to be later on used as material parameters like uniforms. They have no type. They're always stringly typed. So determining the type of the value is the application's responsibility, in our case, the decorative 3D. And the only thing the browser will do is substitute bar statements, like in the third line here. This will be replaced by the browser with the value of custom property in this case. So based on this, we propose one fixed property, it's material model, and this has the type URL, which you can use to either use predefined building shaders like this using URN, or you use a URL that points to a custom shader. And any other property of the material will be set using the custom property specification. And you can see some examples of Vec3, a color matrix, order matrix. This is what we assume for the matrices because this is the standard WebGL layout for matrices. You can define flows and areas and textures as well using a shorthand where you can define the wrapping and the mid mapping and so on. We don't want to use built-in CSS parameters for materials like color or transparency, even though they use is pretty imminent for materials. But if you also use color and transparency, it gets a bit of inconsistent because you have the material parameters starting with double hidden, and then there's some color and you're not sure is it for the element and due to the cascading for some child, or is it really a material parameter? And moreover, you have to define new overloading rules, and CSS has quite many, so introducing another one would be too much. So we stay away from the built-ins and only use the custom property. Next up is an example material. So this is how you could define an example material in CSS. It uses a URL to access, in this case, a shader shader that we also showed yesterday in the tutorial, and we define the material parameters using the proposed syntax, and this simply maps the uniform name in the shader. Next is light configuration for using CSS. We actually usually only use spotlights, point lights, directional lights, just to fix that. So here we could really go with a fixed set of predefined CSS properties, but at least in our group, we strongly believe that custom light shaders are the future and will be coming, so you can use user-defined light types. And to allow this and to not limit the use to only the point spot directional light, we follow the same rules that we did for materials. We just use one fixed property, the light model. It's the same type URL, you use a URN or a URL to point to a shader, and then you define the parameters using the proposed syntax with the double hidden and the custom properties. Camera intrinsic, same way. We have usually an orthographic and a perspective camera. So we could again go with the fixed set, but for consistency and because we want the definition to be usable in systems that are not, possibly not real time, you can have stereoscopic, fisheye, or environmental cameras. So to not limit the use again, we follow the same rule. We use one simple property, camera model, and use again the URL to define the type. And then for the properties, we use the custom material, the custom CSS properties. And here is actually a nice example in CSS, it's usually you have units like pixels or percentage or whatever, and here we can actually use units too, to define the field of view to not get the typical problem of, is it radians, is it degrees? You can just name it and say, hey, it's degrees. I know that and I write it down. Or for clipping planes, we can reuse the auto from CSS, which usually states, okay, just do your automatic calculation for the near field plane. So back to the XML3D scene with what we have defined right now. This was the old scene. And now without all style related elements, I just added a few classes for the CSS to work, which actually is quite nice because it gives a bit more semantics to the elements because the class names really say something about the element and its intention. And the CSS for this, so you can see we define the scene default material just on the root node, and it will cascade and be inherited just like the standard CSS rules. And here you can see we use the on hover to highlight the mesh and to completely avoid any JavaScript to highlight on mouse over, just by using the pseudo class that CSS provides out of the box. A lot of text, so I think it's time for a video to show you this all in action. So it shows our implementation in Firefox. You see I can use the picker in our implementation and just start writing CSS down there in the rules view. And you see it gets started to shade, we change the diffuse color to blue, and we add another parameter roughness for the diffuse highlighting. Next thing is we can use the style editor. I don't know if you know that debugging facility. It allows you to write complete rules in the browser into the debugger. So here we can define a simple property that, as I said, can be used as a variable. So we define a default color and use it as the value for the diffuse color. And everything starts to shade because of the cascading style sheet. And now we can start to highlight a single row or the first column using any CSS selector that is available. So the rows have a number of classes, row 1 to row 10, and so on. And we can use that to simply change the material of this row or column. So this is now using the end child selector, which is pretty, which you can use to iterate over the childs in the DOM tree and select the second or third or each second, each even, each odd element in the tree to style. Or we can just add a new class and go back to the tree, select one of the elements, change its class name, and it should update automatically to the definition that we've just included. Or in the style editor, which is a pretty nice, is we can completely switch between predefined style sheets. So in case we have multiple styles, depending on who's looking at the scene, maybe there's a manager looking at the scene, maybe there's a customer looking at the scene and we want to have them shading, we can use that by simply switching the CSS. So, limitations right now, or let's say obstacles to overcome to implement this. The major problem is the missing style of service, so it's hard to really to get changes and notifications if the style of the element in the DOM changes. This is actually handled by the browser. The browser knows that, but there is no way to get access to these events in JavaScript. So we thought, okay, we don't have it, we start a proposal. This is actually online. It's our first initial draft for style of server to overcome this limitation. That should work like the mutation of server, but on style instead of the DOM position. It's still possible. You can still use, in the worst case, polling approach and just go over and over and check if the style has changed. or you can use the mutation observer to listen to all the DOM changes, check if an ID, class, or anything else changes, which could potentially affect the style, and just reevaluate it. But both are not really affected, but possible. For our system right now, sorry, I've written a small Firefox plugin to simulate these events, but it's still possible without this plugin. Yeah, next thing is there is no API to only query custom CSS properties, so currently you just have to get the whole style of the element and iterate through them, do string comparisons, check if they start with the double hyphen, and then consider them for your material light and camera configuration. So we will start a proposal on such an API as soon as the other is in a better state. Yeah, and there is no API to enable or disable pseudo classes like the onHover. So for the framework, it's currently not possible to say, oh, that element is hovered, and the browser has no idea what your mouse hovers in the canvas and how it relates to the DOM. So there is no connection. So either the framework, like XML3D or X3DOM, has to do that, but there is no API. So we have to see in the future how we could do custom picking on the canvas to say the browser, hey, that's my DOM element that you're currently hovering, and get the onHover state automatically, like it's done for other DOM elements currently. So to conclude, we've provided the first CSS integration for decorative 3D that completely covers materials, light, and camera. It's generic and unified. It's just three simple fixed properties, and everything else is handled using the custom CSS properties specification. So there will be no conflicts for your material parameters with future extensions to CSS, because something in there will name like your material parameter and everything will crash. So it's future-proof, because this is what the DAV3C proposes for custom properties in CSS. And we get automatic access to all the new features that may come, like animations of custom CSS properties. And for sure, it can be implemented already in Firefox. So what's next on the agenda is, now that we have all the three major technologies, I would really like to start doing an empirical evaluation of decorative 3D and how it enables web developers to more easily create 3D content, because this is what we always say. We want to do the decorative thing for the web developers. Now we have all that is necessary to really do an evaluation if this is really true, if it makes it easier for web developers, if they can use their typical technology like CSS in this case. Yeah, CSS-based post-processing. There's a CSS filter approach which you can use to post-process your elements. I would like to use that for 3D content as well, or for the canvas element, and to access the 3D content and do post-processing. Decorative level of detail is always a very exciting topic, and with CSS and custom media queries where we can change style based on screen width and pixel ratio, we may be able to come up with a decorative level of detail based on CSS. And that's more of a question which remains to be researched on, is based on all we have, standardized custom properties, web components, and all the abilities we have in JavaScript, do we need the browser to implement our specification, or can we really just use a JavaScript library to implement decorative 3D and without any browser support for decorative 3D, just user space JavaScript? So thank you very much. Any questions?
Because time is out, so just two fast questions. Any questions? Okay.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for the presentation. At the beginning, you mentioned that you can do three-state mesh, and you said if it is hidden, you will still do one-click selectors. So if I can't see it, can you give me an example of why I would want one-click?
For example, if you have a scanned mesh, which is one large triangle soup, and you want to make specific points clickable, the only way is to either use a tool to cut the mesh into the pieces you want to be interactive currently, because if not, only that whole mesh is interactive. So what is often done is you just overlay a mesh, which is completely transparent, but it proxies the click for that area of interest. And for this is actually the reason I thought it would be nice to have this visible hidden, which acts as this state. So just ignore it during rendering, but you render it in the pick buffer, and you can read back it from the pick buffer. That's the use case that I had in mind. Is answers that the question? Okay.
So now, for point clouds, for example, the similar
yes.
problem.
Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. If no questions, just thanks, GM Shepard.
Streaming of 3D models. So for the first paper, we have Bonita. Please introduce yourself to the audience.
Okay, I'm Bonita Saunders, and I'm a mathematician at the National Institute of Standards and Technology in Gaithersburg, Maryland, in the US. And this is the title of my presentation, Dynamic 3D Visualizations of Complex Function Surfaces Using X3DOM and WebGL. So this is, some of you have heard about this work. It's something that has gone on for many years. So I'm going to give you some background on the work and what we've been doing. And the visualization work has really sort of paralleled the development of 3D graphics on the web. But historically, this is about the development of a digital library of mathematical functions. And it goes back to a work that was published in 1964 by the National Bureau of Standards, which was the original name for the National Institute of Standards and Technology, where I work. And it's a well-known handbook of mathematical functions that was published by NIST, often known by the name Abramowitz and Stegen, the editors of it. So this book was really well used all over the world, and even though it came out in 1964, it's still used today, actually. So NIST decided that since it was somewhat out of date and there were a lot of new functions they'd like to see in it, they decided to update it. And so we had a huge project that started around 1997, where we redid this handbook. And the handbook consists of high-level mathematical functions that are used in engineering and the physical sciences, and things like the Bessel functions, area functions, gamma functions, and some functions that are important in mathematics, like numerical methods, So the authors for this handbook, the original handbook was 1,000 pages, and it contained tables of values of these functions. And so since a lot of that information can be done with packages like Mathematica and Maple, we were thinking that, okay, we'll take most of the tables out, and that should make the book a lot smaller. Well, what happened was there was so much new information that needed to be put in there that the new book also ended up being close to 1,000 pages. So not only is there a book, but there's also a digital version of it that's on the web. And I was involved in managing the development of graphics for that work. The original handbook didn't have that much graphics in it, and it was a handbook, and there was no interactive graphics. So doing it on the web gave us the opportunity to put in some interactive 3D graphics. So this is basically about that work. Now, like I said, this book was created by mathematicians, so they were more interested in the mathematics than the graphics. So the graphics was sort of an afterthought. And so I sort of took on the challenge of looking at the graphics and trying to figure out how we get this graphics on the web and what we could do. And so there are several things that were a problem looking at. These were the three main areas that I had to look at: data accuracy, plot accuracy, and how to render it on the web. The data accuracy for that, well, we just computed the function values by at least a couple of different methods, either using standard packages like Mathematica or Maple, codes from standard repositories, or in some cases using the chapter author's codes. The codes, each chapter in the book or on the website is written by a mathematician who's probably one of the world's experts in that particular function. And so the chapter authors come from all over the United States, all over Europe, Hong Kong, so they're all over the place. So, like I said, and I had the task, or actually took on the task, of trying to develop the graphics for this huge work. So, as far as plot accuracy, well, that concerns whether or not what you see on the screen actually represents the graph of that function. And so, again, like I said, the people who, the mathematicians involved in the project, didn't give too much thought to that. They just thought, well, somehow you make plots and they would magically appear on the web. So when I started looking at it, I looked at packages, I was a little bit surprised at the quality or lack of quality when it came to 3D graphics at that time, let's say late 90s. And if you just did, at that point in time, you just did default plots or functions with a lot of packages, there were some different things you'd see when it came to trying to plot a 3D surface. For instance, one of the things would be what I call bad clipping, you know, where if, let's say this is an array function here, this one, and let's say if you plot it over a rectangle, there's some areas over here where the value of the function goes outside the range of the bounding box. So then they just set the values back and down to whatever they want that height to be, say 5 in this case. So as long as you know what the function looks like, it's not very distractive. But if you're new to the function and you don't know that much about it, then you may not even realize that the shelf areas aren't actually part of the function. And the other thing is, if you clip the function properly, well, when you render it on the web, depending on how it's done, the color map might look non-smooth, as in this one over here on the right. And the other problem is looking at the poles. If the function goes off to infinity, okay, how does it portray that? So I started looking at the problem, and then I realized that maybe I could use my area of research is actually grid generation or mesh generation for computational fluid dynamics problems. So I actually realized that, well, I could probably use that in order to do a better job with these graphs. And so my area of grid generation or mesh generation is actually structured or numerical grid generation, which is just mainly the development of a generalized curvilinear coordinate system, which just means that you got a mapping from some canonical domain to whatever physical domain you're trying to get to or solve the problem on. So I did my research at NASA Langley Research Center. So this is actually just a little toy model, a grid of a toy model of the space shuttle. Any of you who know anything about computational fluid dynamics, you know that if you look at this boundary here, you actually see what looks like the shape of the shuttle. And so the grid is concentrated near the boundary because that's where all the action would be. So I had this mapping that I had created for my dissertation many years ago. So I said, well, maybe I could use that for this. And you can do things with the mapping, like you can minimize an integral, which has like things like the Jacobian of the transformation to smooth the grid. So there are all kinds of things you can do. So okay, so the question is, what does this have to do with the plotting graph, the graphing problem? Well, so I figured that to solve this bad clipping problem, what I really needed was, instead of plotting this area function over a rectangle, what I wanted to do was to figure out the contours of the function. Let's say I only wanted this thing to be plotted to a height of 5. So I just compute the contours of the function, find out where it has a value of 5. These are the contours. And I enclose them so that I have a simple closed curve. And then I create a mesh or a grid inside of that shape. So now, instead of plotting the function over the whole rectangle, I plot over just this grid. So what that does is it gives me a nice clip here. I don't have the shelf area, which I have if I were trying to do it over a rectangular mesh. And also, you notice that it also improves the color map. I don't have the shadowy areas anymore, or it improves them. It may not get rid of them entirely. So I decided that we could use this for the graphics and for this Digital Library of Mathematical Functions project. And this, for instance, is a graph of the Riemann zeta function, a function that's important in numerical analysis. And this is the grid I use to graph that. So notice that it has a shape. These are the contours representing this area here. And then you have a hole in the grid representing where the pole is. And then you have this area here where it clips this. Okay, so the other problem was the file formats for these 3D graphs. And how to get it onto the web. Well, when we started in the 1990s, notice I said that this work really paralleled the work of graphics on the web. In the 1990s, well, VRML or Bromo was the thing. So we actually did the original work in Bromo. And so this project actually started in 1997. And this book and the website, the Digital Library, actually came out in 2010. So that's how long the project was. And I think it was 36 chapters, 30 or so authors. So it was a huge project. And so when Bromo was basically superseded by X3D, then we translated our work to X3D. Chiming Wong, one of the people on our project, had written a translator that some of you have used, which would translate the code from Bromo 97 format to X3D format. So when we actually launched the DLMF in 2010, we did the visualizations were actually presented in both Bromo and X3D format. Later, we changed them to Web3. WebGL, but that's I'll get to that in a minute. So the advantages and disadvantages of Bromo and X3D are well known. Being able to explore the graphs in 3D, turn them around is an advantage, and the disadvantage, having the plugins, and in our case, we really experienced all of the advantages and disadvantages. And so whenever we change the operating system or the plugin was updated, half the time our stuff would break. But we had this additional problem that many of the plugins couldn't display our stuff. We had this complex cutting plane feature that was the most complicated part of the graphics. Like, so in this graphics, we have several things. We have a color map control, where it's colored by height or by the argument of the function, which we call the phase. And we have this cutting plane feature, which lets you move a plane through the surface and look at the intersection of the plane with the surface. But this turned out to be the most complicated feature to implement. And so even though we found a way to do it, and we thought we were satisfying all the normal X3D ISO standards, it still would depend on what browser we use. Some browsers it would work on certain platforms, like with the Mac and with Windows, and for some it didn't. And we were never able to find a browser that would work for our stuff in the Linux environment. And this is just an example of what when we had the Roman format, what it looked like. We had this prototype that created the Roman file. But the key part of it is that we had it separated into surfaces. So each surface actually represents a grid. So if the grid were very complicated, what I did was I divided it into several sections. So we had basically a proto for each section. So each, like S1, S2 would be two grids, basically, for that particular. So that made it pretty complicated. And like I said, so it didn't work on a lot of different browsers. So actually in 2000, when we found out about X3DOM and WebGL, that was actually a lifeline for us, because no longer would we need the plugin. It made our work a lot easier. So now, once we made the transition, the visualizations can be viewed in all kinds of, all platforms, basically. And I'm going to show, since I don't have a lot of minutes left now, I'll show maybe one video now and one example now. But tonight, during Sandy's presentation, I'll also give demos of the graphics. But just to show one, so this is a gamma function, a 3D gamma function. So this is actually the absolute value of the complex gamma function. And so this is using WebGL. So you turn the surface around any way you want. And then we put in canned viewpoints. And this is the color map. So here it's colored by the modulus. Here's one of the colorings by phase, or the argument of function. So basically, since this is really a complex value function, so the argument would be the argument if you viewed the complex as a complex number. And the quadrant is still the argument, it's just telling you what quadrant the value falls in. And you can scale it down in various directions. Well, the coordinate directions. And like I said, the most complicated feature is the cutting plane control. So what it does is it creates a plane and moves it through the surface, and it shows the intersection of the plane with the surface. So actually, or so you can say you see slices as it goes through. And so we have these DVD or VCR-like controls that run automatically, or you can push the plane through. You can also put in values. Let's say you wanted the WAG of 0 because you want to see what the real part looks like. So that's just one example. So actually there are, in the site, there are over 200 3D visualizations. And there are actually over 600 graphs total. So there are quite a few of them are 2D ones. And so one of the things, so for the future, what we're looking at is, one of the things that I'd like to do is, I remember the old CosmoPlayer browser, how you could actually do what I call a continuous or basically a perpetual spin by, you know, flicking the surface, and it would keep spinning. That's one of the features that I'd like to have implemented in the in our 3D graphics. And the other thing is to look at the animation of the 2D plots. Right now, all those are just fixed. Probably doing something like what you can do in Mathematica, where you have the manipulate option, and you go in, you can change the parameters and change the graph that way. And another thing is creating a true zoom. Right now, you can zoom in and out on the surfaces, but the data is fixed, so you're not really getting any additional information. So, but creating a true zoom would require being able to compute the function on the fly. And some of these functions are very complicated to compute. Some of the codes are like, the author is like the world expert in that particular function, and he may be the only one who's actually created code that will compute that function. So that's going to be the one of the challenging parts of that, and the other is developing the mesh generation that I need for that, probably some hierarchical method for that. I have here monitoring the progress of Microsoft with IE support. Okay, well, that's in pretty good shape now, although I know you have to use a pretty late browser to make sure it works. But because we still don't have complete confidence in that, we actually offer the visualizations in Vrml, X3D, and with the X3DOM WebGL version. What we'd like to do in the future is to drop the standalone Vrml and standalone X3D formats and just have the X3DOM WebGL version. But we'll see if we have confidence in it working on every platform, because this is available to free for free for anybody. Okay, so that's it.
Thank you very much. Do you have any questions?
Yeah, thanks for the presentation. So a nice system. And my question would be that, have you also thought about functionality to visualize instead of single functions, which is of course an important task, to visualize multiple functions so that users can compare different functions, for example, by small multiples or overlays, that may be an extension for the visualization. Have you heard from users whether that would be useful?
No, I haven't. Like I said, well, I can't say most of the users are math. They're mathematicians and engineers, and a lot of them are mainly interested in the mathematical part of the values of the functions and the properties of the functions. But that's actually interesting. Well, one thing I would advise, I advise you to try this out. This is the URL. And one thing we're going to do is, some people have complained that they can't find the graphics. So one thing we're doing in the next update is we're having, in the table of contents, we're having actually putting a list of figures options in there, which shows all of the figures in there, not just the 3D, and so that people can find the graphics better. But there's a feedback section in there at the bottom of just about every page, I think. So if you try the site out and you have some ideas like that, I mean, that sounds like a good one. It would be great if you could actually send an email to feedback to let us know that, like, oh, why don't you do this? And also it would be good because most of the feedback they get are from, like I said, people who are interested in the mathematics. They get very little feedback about the graphics. People look at it and go, oh, that's great, you know, and I don't hear anything. So it would be nice to hear from audience like this, you know, what they think of the graphics, or ideas about different things that can be done. It would let me know and also let the other editors know that, okay, people are really interested in the graphics, and so let's push that. Because I'm really the one who's like driving the graphics for this, and our other, I always say that Sandy is sort of like our other PR person, you know, who's pushed a lot of this over the years. But that would be great. So I really encourage you to look at it and try it out. Yes,
please. Okay. So let me echo the thank you. This is very important. Make a couple offers to you as well, Benita. I think your work is very important to the working group to make sure that we're doing all the right things. I mean, graphics, computer graphics would not exist if it weren't for a solid mathematical basis. So in many cases, this is a return to our foundation. We were very happy to add clipping plane and get that to work to the spec. So the two offers is first, tell us if there's a problem, we'll help with anything we can do. And second, I don't know if you want to call it drop extra D Bermel. You know, we call it actually classic Bermel. Again, I'm marketing impaired. I didn't make that up, but
I almost took that slide out. I said, okay, I think I'm going to have trouble with that.
Well, let me make it a positive. If X3D is central to X3DOM. I mean, if you look at
right.
The HTML page, it's HTML, X3D, HTML. Okay. So for your classic approach, how you did it, even if that's no longer preferred, I think it still has long-term interest. So we would be happy to host it if you guys don't want to, or make sure that that resource has a proper place and that others can compare, contrast, continue to improve. So.
Okay, all right. Well, I mean, that also would be something, let me encourage you again to send information to feedback, if you could say something about that so that we have that on record. No. Okay. Other questions?
I would like to ask if you have somehow evaluated the additional computational cost of your improvements from the GPU of the system.
No, not really. But one thing I noticed, and I guess I attended the X3DOM tutorial yesterday, which was very good. Like I said, the cutting plane is the most advanced thing in here. And that's what we had the most trouble with. And when we did it in Bermel / just X3D, the classic, the cutting plane, especially in the Z direction, was really slow. But so when we reprogrammed it into X3DOM and WebEL, all of a sudden it was more efficient, it was smoother, the lines were better. So it was like we got these improvements for free just by translating. And so now, but it still, the grid size does make a difference on the loading. If it's a really complicated grid, it can take a little while to load and affect the performance of the cutting plane movement a little bit, but not what it did, what it used to do. So it's been a big improvement.
So, thank you very much. The next paper is also on X3DOM development, combination of AngularJ, JavaScript, and X3DOM, and will be presented by Mr. Joseph Dobos.
And I might as well just show you a quick demo, if this thing ever works, and if all demo gods are with me. There we go. So this desktop application can connect, in this case, locals, because the internet sucks here. And this is actually the raw database. So you have different models and sections of it. So if I show you what the model looks like, this is a transfer. This is a federation of models. So we have a number of references. It's a flat collection of binary JSON objects. It's literally key value pairs. And it's a polymorphic, so you can have different stuff. So for example, I have a matrix. As you might have guessed, is an identity. Just keeps on going. And you can add any types of projects, objects, items into the database. And if I show you the kind of stuff we have to deal with, so this is a section of a bridge. Not very interesting, but what I want to show you is the selection tree. So this is something called IFC, Industry Foundation Classes. It's a special format used in the construction industry. And it's mess. Have a look. This is what I have to deal with. See all these transformations? And it keeps on going. It's insane. And there you go, right? And finally you get a material on this. So you can load these models, we decompose them, make them into nice neat package of stuff, and you've got about 1,353 nodes. You can push it to the database, write a commit message, and you would use it like you would use a Git, but instead of using Git, we use Mongo database. So this is the very background of the stuff. Where we are, there you go. Plenty of text, don't bother. Next, this is the important one. In the construction industry, so my doctoral research was sponsored by ARUP, multinational engineering construction company, 10,000 employees across the world. The construction industry itself is extremely complicated because there is never one company doing stuff. So you start with clients, they say, okay, I want a building, then you keep on going, architects do the designs, engineers, so on. Someone else has to go and build it. So tier one contractors, massive companies, the Olympic Stadium is done by Balfour Beatty, largest construction company in the UK, turnover of £10 billion. They don't physically build stuff, they just hire tier two contractors who go and build stuff. So on the Olympic Stadium, we have 22 different companies working on it, and on the entire side, there was one guy who could power up our computer to render the thing. So that's what we have to deal with. There is another interesting quote from industry expert. When you do tenders, you are given a specification for a building and you have to cost it. And we know of a case where a guy forgot to cost an entire floor, therefore his bid was the cheapest and he won. But someone has to pay for it, right? So how are we going to prevent that? This is a very low motivation. So in 2011, the UK government mandated the use of something which is called building information modeling. I'm not going to go into details. There's plenty of stuff, history, draft, how you started with CAD and moving on to 3D and so on. 2016 is the deadline. In the UK and many other countries across Europe, if you don't comply with the standard, which is specified by the British Standards Institution for common data environments, so literally common repository of data, you are not allowed to do public projects. There we go. So what have you got a problem with? There is deliberate vendor locking, right? Many different companies and big ones, I shall not mention them, start with A, they deliberately want you to use their software, not another company starting with B, right? Similar to a car, mentally. So, I mentioned industry foundation classes. There is an example. It's a massive mess, and this is what we have to deal with. It contains a lot of engineering information, some of which is not applicable to, let's say, you can't use it for infrastructure projects, so high bays and stuff like that, because you just can't present that. But trust me, somewhere here, you extract 3D data with I don't know how magic. So what are contributions in this paper? We come up with a practical solution, moving from academic research into commercial environment, making sure it's applicable, secure, and you can actually use it. Improving the NoSQL database schema from previous work. We simplified the REST APIs we presented 2 years ago, and we do a number of comparisons of jQuery and AngularJS because we just like latest cool stuff. Related work, I'm going to skip this. Feel free to read the paper. This is an important bit. So we start with the database. This is the very deep core of the servers. It's behind two firewalls with a private key encryption so that you have a tunnel. You have to have a trusted server with whitelisted IP addresses to even get to that. And basically you have a bouncer service which communicates with the database and, as the name suggests, he manages the access. Now you've got a number of compute nodes to actually go and do the heavy lifting computationally expensive tasks. 3D Repo IO, which is the kind of system presented in the paper, it's basically Node.js web server and REST API, which is separated as separate services for scalability purposes. And finally, we've done web client as a combination of X3DOM and AngularJS. 2 years ago, we've done work with Christian using XML3D, so we just use another piece of tech just to see what happens. Now, AngularJS and jQuery. How many of you have heard of Angular before and used it? Okay, so you know what I'm talking about, perfect. I won't bother because I don't know what's going on. It's difficult, I'm told the learning curve is quite steep. The idea is that you've got a single page, you've got a controller which dynamically loads stuff, and it's kind of similar to Ajax, but more complicated, and you've got dynamic routing on the client, so you wouldn't even hit the server, you just keep loading JSON objects to populate the page, magic. Now, jQuery is the kind of traditional way of manipulating DOM. You basically have listeners, selectors, and you go directly. AngularJS, on the other hand, has to parse stuff, and it doesn't really like manipulating DOM. If you really have to do it, you have to do directives, you have to parse the entire thing, and only afterwards you can do something. So the question we posed was, can we use it for manipulating 3D models? And if we can, what kind of implications in terms of performance we get. In terms of database, we've done a number of improvements, so we included new map node for the database, so we can actually load Google Map tiles. Long story, won't go into detail. We also done federation, so you can put multiple projects together. For those familiar with GitHub, you would have some modules loading different projects, very similar idea. And we also have metadata attached directly to the SynGraph. So SynGraph is represented as a directed async graph in the database, and it's data agnostic. We couldn't care less what goes in. It can be metadata, it can be PDF objects, it can be meshes, materials, you name it, everything goes into the same data structure. By the way, this project we're looking at is A63 Hybris project in City of Hull in the UK. And yeah, you can load project info and stuff. Yeah, cool. Now, how do we actually go about testing Angular versus jQuery? Well, we devised the testing scene, which is 10,000 little spheres, and we decided to flash them. So they are switching on and off colors, and it makes a nice flashing video, I'm sure that it's a lot of stuff. Now, you would have to get you to go and code it somehow, so I just got a snippet. You get those switching things as directives, and Angular has to go and parse it. Yeah, once there's a magic, the results. So, we've done three experiments. In the first one, we've been switching nodes and increasing the number of nodes as we switch them. So you notice this logarithm is going up, and jQuery is slightly worse off and then overtakes Angular. And it obviously has a performance hit. You can read the paper for details how we set up the experiment. Basically, we try to equalize them as much as possible. So Angular would literally look into an array of booleans and change the color of increasing number of nodes randomly, while jQuery would just go through the selectors. We also done another experiment where we changed the size of the grid, so the number of nodes, and we changed the colors again. Now you see there is a significant change, and Angular has a kind of constant overhead no matter how many nodes in the sync graph you've got. And finally, there is a compile time. By the way, you notice there is a wrong label. It's also in the paper. I couldn't be able to change it. Point being, this is a massive disadvantage of AngularJS versus jQuery. You have to compile the page, and if it's extremely complex, it's going to take you a lot of time to compile it, so the user won't see anything, although you might have other performance advantages. Here is an example scene. This is once again IFC, Industry Foundation Classes from Building Smart website. You can download the model. It's an interesting one. So we've done also comparison of how you actually go and load the data from the server to the client. So as I said, we decompose those massive models into database, and those are fetched as X3D individual meshes, objects, and so on. And because we have different options, we tried what can we get out of them. And as you can see, SRC turns out to be quite good because it's a reasonable balance between number of requests, because the meshes are merged together, and also the file size. However, you have a constant overhead on response headers as well as the actual header inside SRC. So once again, something to take into account. The next thing we are looking to implement is multipart, where you can actually merge multiple meshes together, but still be able to click them to lower the number of requests even further. Also, other important point, if you've got that many requests, it's going to kill your browser, it will crash. So even to get these numbers, we have to progressively load it slowly, because otherwise the browser just can't handle it. In terms of the REST API, we've done a number of improvements since the previous paper. So originally, the way we devised it was a combination of ID and type for objects. And depending on the order in which you did, the API was doing all sorts of incredible things. You could query objects, collections of objects, individual attributes, and so on, but it was extremely difficult. So we simplified it for commercial purposes. So now we also take into account logging, credentials, people get session cookies, and so on. And as you can see, we also added accounts and projects, which is very similar to what you would have on GitHub, where people log in either as a company, and then you would have number of projects or as an individual user, but the same thing applies. You also specify revisions, so the stuff with two dots is variables, and this is a fixed string. You can specify the branch under which you want to go, and the revision ID. So all of these IDs are UUIDs. That that you basically attach to objects in the database. We've done also a number of industrial use cases. Here is the Olympic Stadium example of scene graph optimization. So it was evaluating the polygons not much, but the complexity of the scene was enormous. So we optimized it before serving. We also added caching into the database directly. So we store the X3D representation in the database, which can go out to the client. Here's another example of federation. This is a project by Arup. It's proposed building the shape of a human. It's actually laser scan of one of the employees, and they represented ventilation as lungs and electricity as veins and that kind of stuff. And we basically federate all these different models into one single representation database, and those are pointing to subprojects. This is an example of what you can do. And wayfinding user studies, one was interesting. So in Arup, what they would do, they give users three screens and a joystick, and they tell them navigate from platform A to platform B, and they record the paths, and they do it on desktop using Quest 3D, which is game engine, similar to Unity. However, doing so, you can only record a number of people in the office, and what we decided to do is do the same thing, but in the web browser. Because you just copy-paste the web, you don't have to install anything, because it runs on WebGL, we can record tens of thousands of people. And what we do is, every second we get a position and orientation of the camera, we double buffer it, and we push it every 10 seconds to the server. You store it, and afterwards you can plot with the police how people wander out. Use it to actually evaluate the signage in the space before you physically build it to save cost, make sure you don't have problems. On the MTR Admiralty Station, I think they had 245 problems with the signage. For example, Chinese characters being positioned flipped, right? No one in London noticed. So you can resolve it before you build it, and that is really good for them. Yeah, we compared AngularJS. Conclusion basically is that Angular is really good for doing the web stuff for navigation. It has the dynamic model which updates the UI for you, and it's really good for building the UI stuff, but don't mix it with X3DOM. It just performance hit is too much. So you're better off for separating the X3DOM using standard jQuery selectors and AngularJS for everything else, and we've done exactly that. So now the X3DOM viewer is basically simple embeddable separate thing which you can use like a YouTube video embedded in some pages. You don't have to use the user interface that goes with it. Improve the database schema and you can read the rest. And we quite like SRC, and we have a number of ideas how to go about improving. We are also working with Canary Wharf Group, and here is a mock-up. This actual screenshot, and this little thing is a mock-up. How you can use, once again, web-based stuff for lease management. There is a lot of money to be made. This is us taking video footage on-site in Newfoundland's flat. We added also support for QR code reading, so you can scan a QR code, load a section of the model directly using your handheld device. Here's an example of 3D diff running in the web browser, so you can compare two versions of a model. You basically select revision of which branch you want, and the same for the other view, and we actually highlight what has and what hasn't changed. The next step is how to actually convey the changes, because having the whole thing green and red doesn't tell you much. So we are going to split it into packages. This is us. We are funded by a lot of stuff, so we got grants, £500,000 of these guys, Innovate UK. We won by the word. We have projects with all of these guys, and we are hiring. So I think it's, if you're interested, guys, by the end of summer, we need to grow to 6. You get in touch. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joseph. You were very fast. Any questions? Yes, please.
Yeah, there's a white paper out on cybersecurity and repositories and CAD. In fact, somebody borrowed the paper yesterday, if you could get it back to me. But they talk about assurance and integrity and making sure that things aren't altered surreptitiously. And of course, everything bits can become physical and vice versa. So how is that impacting your current thinking, please?
In the database, for version control purposes, we never delete anything ever. It only grows. I mean, it's been insane. But we, exactly for the legal reasons, we have to maintain a log of changes. And we came across a case where a client, for the contractors, changed the model. without telling the contractors they built it, and now they're having a legal case for millions of pounds. And the contractors said if they use this system, something like that would have never happened. So consistency of data is a massive issue. The Mongo database itself doesn't have any schema, so it's potentially dangerous. That's why we even introduced the bouncer service, which maintains the integrity and checks that you are only allowed to do certain things and no one else. So you wouldn't be able to get raw access to the database. So the demo I showed you is actually old stuff, and since that, it already changed. The other thing we got is a project ongoing with British Telecom for High Impact Initiative, EIT ICT Labs, Trusted Cloud Environment. So they've got an online system for protection on the servers, packet sniffing, patches, and it's an interface to all the providers, Azure, Amazon, Rackspace, and so on. So we are the beta tester for the system using our data and basically creating deployable Node.js solution that you can just run and install it. So what you can see in the video is actually the A63 Castle Street Improvements project, and there is a federation of existing conditions there, and the map tiles and so on, and you can see how it loads. So it doesn't have to be the other demo I forgot to show. It doesn't have to be city, right? It can be individual buildings. I had to preload this because the Wi-Fi here sucks, but you know, it's incredible detail that you can run in the browser. And my laptop doesn't have a graphics card, so I'm very thankful for that Geo and X3DOM and so on. It's really great. Thank you.
Sorry.
Joseph, may I ask you something?
Yeah.
You said that there is a requirement to develop collaborative platforms for construction, if I understood right. Do you have a plan to include such a facility at your development? I mean, collaboration. How do you succeed collaboration?
So, the British Standards Institution only defines standards, so it's something called PAS 1192 and seven versions of the document. It's very long, and it only tells you what you should do, it doesn't tell you how you should do it. So we are aiming to be one of the providers of an applicable standard to comply with the requirements. So what they call it common data environment. They tell you what roughly it should do, but they don't tell you how. So we are trying to come up with an answer how to go about this. Because normally people use solutions similar to Dropbox. There is something called Business Collaborator, which is quite popular. And you just upload files, and all of the Autodesk products and Bentley Project Wireless, they're always dealing with files. We decompose the data, we use database because we're handling data, not using the file system, we're using database.
So are there some favorite technologies to take into account for collaboration? Do you have a think about it? Or?
We are not trying to replace existing solutions, so if someone is using Revit or someone is using Maya or whatever else, we wouldn't do that. There is an ongoing company called Onshape. They've got $64 million investment. It's entire SolidWorks team. I would highly recommend have a look. It's literally Google Docs, but for 3D. You can go and edit geometry directly in browser. That's what we are not trying to do. On this project, there is 32 different types of software they're using. There is no way one piece of software can replicate all of it. So we are using more traditional approach of similar to version control systems like Git and SVN. You do stuff in whatever solution you already use, and then upload and detect the delta changes, and then store them and visualize it. That's basically it.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Okay, hello, good morning everybody. My name is Sergio Garcia. I come from the Technical University of Madrid in Spain, where I'm studying my PhD, and I'm going to show you the work that we have done on obtaining point clouds that are visually better than traditional clouds by using texture splats, and which can be rendered smoothly in handheld devices. This is the structure of my presentation. I will start with a brief introduction on the topic that we are addressing. I will then give you a general overview of our system, and then I will go into more details of the different steps. And finally, I will present you some of the results that we have, and we'll end up with some conclusions. Here you can see some point clouds, which do not look quite good because they have been obtained with a structure from motion techniques based on a set of photographs that have been taken from a building or an object, And you can see that there are a lot of areas without information, a lot of holes, and therefore these models do not look quite natural. For instance, here you have the Torre de Belém in Lisbon, and some of the photographs that we have used to obtain the 3D model. As I said, this model has a lot of holes, and even if you want to look closer to the point cloud, you will get that the space between points is growing bigger and bigger as you get closer, which makes the model look non-realistic. And you can decide to increase the size of the points, but then you get a lot of different colors between the different points, and also the sharp edges of the squares make them look very unnatural. So this is where we want to improve the quality of the render point clouds by using texture splats. Here you can see the different steps of our process. We start with a traditional point cloud, and then we compute the splats, which are uniformly colored, and finally we apply a texture to the splats to make them look more natural and more similar to what you can get with a traditional polygonal mesh. Okay, so this is the overview of our system. We start with a 3D point cloud, which, as I said, has been obtained through an SFM engine using a set of images of a certain scene and the camera calibration parameters. First, we have a base model generation step where we get one model which has where each point is replaced by an splat. However, this model has two disadvantages because the number of primitives is too high to be rendered fluidly in a mobile device, and then the texturing algorithm doesn't work very well with these small splats, and we need to make them bigger so that the results are more natural. So we have to include a simplification step which generates a refined model that can be textured to obtain a texture atlas, and in this step now we have the 3D model ready to be rendered in any mobile device. So I will start with the base model generation. Here, as I said, we want to replace each point by an elliptical splat, and we use principal component analysis to try to estimate the underlying surface around the certain point. And for this purpose, we use the neighbor points of the cloud. This gives us the tangential and normal directions of the surface, which are unitary vectors and have to be scaled by the data variance. We also can think of moving the splat to the average point of its neighbors, or leaving it in the original point location. And we have seen that each of these possibilities has drawbacks and advantages. So we define a measure of the flatness of the certain region, and based on this measure, we decide to locate the point in the original position or move it to the average point. And finally, we also have to orientate the normal properly so that it looks it points to the outside of the model. This is needed for the multi-texturing step, and we can do it because we know the camera positions, and this way we can correct the normal orientation. Here you can see the result of this basic splat model, which doesn't look quite natural. You can see that it seems to have a lot of noise because there are many different colors between near splats, and they are really small, so we will try to improve it in the simplification step, which is what follows. Here, what we want to try is to reduce all the overlaps that appear between near splats and merge them to look bigger. We have developed a two-stage simplification method. The first one is very quick, but it's also coarse. Because we want to reduce as many overlaps as possible, and then we will go to a second stage which is more accurate, but it's also slower. In the first stage, we will try to reduce the overlapping between splats by merging all the spans that look in the same direction and which are close enough, and we will replace them by an average helix. Here you can see a simple example where we have these red splats, and if we look at the central splat, we can define a sphere around it with its radius will be as a parameter epsilon 1, and this parameter will allow us to simplify more or less the model depending on the application where we want it. So here, when we have this sphere, we will select all the splats whose center lays on the inside. These are the ones in green, and all of them will be replaced by an average ellipse, like the one in blue. However, this ellipse doesn't cover all the space that was occupied by the previous splats, so we will have to enlarge it so that it occupies the same space. However, we don't want it to cover all the initial splats, so we define another parameter, epsilon 2, which will be also used to obtain finally more or less simplification. So now we get to the second stage, where we will look at the splats in pairs to look for the overlaps between them. And here, when we find a relevant overlap between two splats, we will replace them by the minimum enclosing ellipsoid of these two splats. Here, for instance, the blue splat is going to be merged with the red ones, but only with those ones where the overlapping is relevant. You can see that here the process will stop because the red splat on the left may be considered not to be relevant. And this is good because we won't get so many holes between the splats if we follow this approach. Here you can see the result from the same monument, which I forgot to say is Palazzo Madama in Turin. And here the colors have been smooth, and you can see that the ellipses are bigger. However, the model still doesn't look quite natural because there are a lot of pixels which are colored with the same color. So now it's time to move to the texturing step, which will add some realism to the model. So now we have to use the initial set of images that were used previously to generate the point cloud and the camera parameters. Here we apply a multi-texturing algorithm that computes a texture atlas where we try to reduce the seams and the artifacts between using different images for the texturing. And we will obtain the three texture coordinates that are needed for every splat so that we can later on interpolate the right texture coordinate for all the pixels inside the splat. And this algorithm leads to these results where we can see that the previous point cloud has been textured. And well, there are also some errors in this cloud because sometimes you can notice the transitions between the closest splats, but the model seems more natural than the original point cloud. And we can still see that the holes that were present at the beginning keep being here in the point cloud because they have not been fully covered by these splats. Now we have a model ready to be rendered in a handheld device, and we have implemented shaders for OpenGL ES, and we are using point primitives instead of triangle primitives, but these points are modified because we have to provide the information that you can see here, namely the center of the splat, the axis of the ellipse, and the three texture coordinates that have been previously computed. This leads us to a splat that has 15 floats of information, which are quite more than the six floats per point that are needed by the typical point cloud, where you only have the position and the color. However, although this seems to be an increase in the size of the models because of the simplification stage that we have previously talked about, the final size of the models are really reduced compared to the original ones, as I will show you later in the results. Here we have the same building as before, the Torre de Belém. On the left you can see the original point cloud, and on the right you have the texture splat model. Here you have a closer look at it, where you can see that the texture splat model has a more natural feeling than the original point cloud. But however, you can still see the holes in those areas of the model where no information was retrieved by the SFM engine. That is one thing that we're currently working on, try to reduce them as much as possible and therefore make the model look more like a polygon mesh. Here I also want to show you some numerical results in terms of the size of the models. You can see the number of points of four datasets that we have used, and the number of splats, which is more or less 10 times smaller. And then I also compared the number of floats for the original point cloud and the final splat models. You can see that we achieve reductions between 69% and 86% of the size of the models, which is quite a lot of reduction, and also the quality has been improved. So here I show you my conclusions, which are that we have managed to deliver a system where we can obtain texture splat models, which not only they are visually better than the point clouds, but you have also they have also a smaller size, which is not only important for the storage requirements, but also for transmission if you want to stream the models across the network. And besides, since the number of primitives has been drastically reduced, they can be rendered smoothly in any mobile device. However, one of the main drawbacks of this approach is that you need a set of photographs from the object. You cannot take a point cloud from the net and apply this algorithm because you need a set of images of the object. And also what I told you previously about the holes that are present in the model, because no information was retrieved and therefore no splats were generated where the point cloud was empty. And that is all from my side. Thank you very much for your attention.
Any question, please?
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. I don't know if you saw my presentation yesterday about multi-resolution point clouds, which is similar in many respects. And I played around with PCA with the octree that I used to get the normal for each cluster of points, and that allows you to do a multi-resolution thing whereby you load in lower resolution data point clouds first, and then you progressively refine it.
Yeah.
It seems to me that the algorithm used to aggregate the splats from several things into one is a natural extension of multi-resolution thing, and I think here in the web 3D community we're always interested in sort of progressive refinement of data, so you can download a lower resolution version first and have it progressively refine. And it seems to me that your approach would be quite ideal for that, you know, because you're already aggregating, you've already got the algorithm to combine several splats. And have you thought about going into that in that direction as well?
Yeah, that's true. We were not thinking of this multi-resolution algorithm, but it's true that once you have merged these splats, you might get a history of which splats have been merged, and then you can refine the model and have different layers of content that can be streamed to have the different multi-resolutions. So yes, that would be a very good future work for.
Let's check later on, because I've got half of it working. So if I got half working, you've got half working.
Yeah. Any other question? I'm glad to ask you. You said that with your method there is a reduction of the size of the files. Do you have also such a reduction at the time it takes to render? Could you estimate how long it takes to render such a model?
No, we haven't really checked that render time. It's
I think there might not be such a reduction in the, but it depends on the device that you are using. But in the mobile devices, for instance, the initial point cloud cannot be rendered. Maybe it is like 1 frame per second. It's not acceptable. But with our approach, you can have a fluid render. When you try to rotate the model, it turns immediately. So that. But we have not, we did not check the actual numbers.
Yes, please.
Just a question, how much does the texture weigh?
The texture, you can define the resolution that you want, but here for the mobile devices we have used the 1000 by 1000 pixels, and they're usually around 5 megabytes or so. So these numbers, the texture has not been included, but it's very small compared to the actual size of the models.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For the next paper, we have Rafael, also from Spain, from the same university, and similar.
Hi, good morning everybody. My name is Rafael Pajes. I'm also coming from Technical University of Madrid in Spain. I'm a colleague of Sergio, and I'm going to present you further work we've done in not only the only using the splats for rendering a point cloud, but also some modeling that we're doing to turn part of this point cloud into a mesh and render it together. So, as you see, we will call it splash as a mixture of mesh and splats. Well, so this is the problem. You saw a point cloud similar to this one in Sergio's presentation. So nowadays we have very dense point clouds that comes from scanners, from lidars, from motion, structure from motion, based techniques, and so we have really big models, models with a lot of information that cannot normally be handled in the web or in the mobile devices. So as we are moving to the web, we really want to do something with them. One approach could be Sergio's, and we'll show you something else. So if we render point clouds, they really need to be very dense to be detailed. If you go, as Sergio showed you, if you go really close to the model, you will see that there's a gap between the points, so you have to do some kind of trick. It could be splats, it could be something else, but it really has to be very dense if you want to use a big model for any purpose. And again, if you're using structure from motion, you'll see that there will be parts, as it's feature-based techniques, as flat areas, as white wall or something like that, there won't be any features, so you won't have any information at all, and that's not acceptable if you want a nice model, a nice refined model. And if you bother to just recover the surface in, that lies in the point cloud to create a mesh, you'll have the problem that the model will be like super dense, because it will have at least as much information as the point cloud, but also the polygon information. And if you decimate it to get a lower count, polygon count mesh, you will see that you're going to lose a lot of accuracy. So you have to really care about if you want accuracy, if you want a lot of detail, or if you just want a simple mesh. So for this, we're going to mix the best of very simple meshes which has a very low polygonal count, and elliptical splats that Sergio introduced before. So you'll see how we're going to use the elliptical splats to render or to model the details of a mesh, and everything we can get using a mesh, we will just use a polygon mesh, a traditional one. So, right. So here is what we have again. We have a point cloud, a very dense point cloud. It could be acquired using a structure from motion, as I said before. We also have a set of photographs that we've taken. So. The first thing we're going to do is to process the point cloud so we can get what we would call like a simple mesh, using only a few, not using all the information provided by the point cloud. So the first stage would be to remove the noise of the point cloud, because as you know, in these SFM based techniques, you have a lot of false positives sometimes, and you also have some points that you don't really care about, like matches in the sky or in the background or something like that. So we're going to use a statistical outlier removal filter, so to remove all the possible noise. And then we're going to do something. We're going to make an assumption here, is that the models that we're going to reconstruct are going to be based on simple shapes. That means that in our case, that we reconstructed buildings. It could be most of buildings are formed by planes, cylinders, and very regular shapes like that. So we're going to make a point cloud segmentation based on that we're searching for planes and cylinders made. So for instance, this is a point cloud of the one I didn't tell. The last one was also a monument in Turin, this Arco Valentino, and this is the Palazzo Carignano, if I remember correctly. And you see here, we will do perform a point cloud segmentation, and we will see, for instance, in this case, three major planes of points. The important thing here is that even when we are segmenting the point cloud and we're keeping all these sub point clouds representing planes or cylinders, that it could be also, we're not deleting the points that do not that are not belonging to any shape. So we're going to keep them because later we will do something with them. So once we know, once we have done the segmentation, we also estimate the normals, as you can see here in kind of blue or purple, I don't know. You can see the representation of the normal estimated using a small neighborhood and PCA analysis. And as you know, this will give you the normal, but it could be flipped. So we use the position of the cameras, the calibrated cameras, to determine if it's flipped or not. It's important also to notice that we're going to do this per segmented sub-point cloud. So for instance, if we have two planes that are making a 90 degrees angle, you will have all the normals of one of the planes oriented in the correct direction, and if there's one which is not in that direction, it will be removed that point and added to the points that are not belonging to the plane. And again, we'll have the same, so there will be like a sharp edge in the connection of the two planes. And this is important because the next step is doing a surface reconstruction. We're using Poisson in this case. This is the model of the Palazzo Carignano I showed you before. And this mesh, I don't know if you work with Poisson reconstruction, but it would normally give you like a closed surface. So we're cleaning that surface and retrieving only the triangles and the vertices which are close to the original point cloud and in a connected area, and also decimating the mesh. So now that we know that these are planes, we can really decimate them. We're not going to lose a lot of a lot of detail of the original model that we have, because we have segmented this point and we know that they are more or less planes. So this slide may be familiar to you. So what we're going to do is take the points that we're not belonging to any of these planes and calculate the splat that is lying in them. So we're doing a calculation similar to what Sergio did, and we're going to represent all these points as splats. So the next step, again, is multi-texturing, and you will see that using the, again, the Tower of Belém in Lisbon, you will see that using this set of images, we're going to blend the information from the images, not only in the mesh, but also in the splats, using the technique that was presented before. And you can see the resulting model from the original point cloud. Here's the difference. Didn't make so many numbers as Sergio, but I will tell you that this mesh is probably around, it's a, like 20k triangles when originally it was like 500,000 points. And it also has the splats there, and that's a nice thing because as they are textured using the same system, they are like completely inside the render model, and they are not even visible if they are in a place where there's a lot of mesh. Of course, if you go here, you will see a few splats of isolated points that were not cleaned in the filtering process. Here you can see like an example. That's without the splats and with the splats. So you can see, for instance, in the back, this small tower. I don't know how to call it in English, but there's all the shape of the tower is presented by the splats, and it's, as you see, it's seamless compared to what it would be in doing it any other way. So here's another example of a final texture model. So, conclusions. We try to propose a system that uses the best of meshes, the simplicity of the mesh, the topology of the mesh, and how can you simplify it as much as you want. And we've also the elliptical 3D splats to use detail, and that's the idea. So we can get a very simple or very light model that can be very realistic and also can be presented in a website, or it can be held in a mobile device. So it can only, I've shown you different results using structure from motion point clouds, but in this case it could be with any other, as long as we always have the photograph, so it's not just for that the kind of point clouds. And yeah, the amount of information is reduced, but the detail is still preserved. So for instance, the point cloud of the Palazzo Carignano, it was originally more than 1 million points, and at the end the resulting model is like 25k triangles and a couple thousand of splats, and the result, it's I think nice. So thanks, you have any questions?
I'll do the first question and then I'll follow. You are competing to each other at the university?
No. Actually, this is what Sergio is doing. He's a very interesting way of trying to avoid meshes at all. But this is we're trying to go farther. But if you saw, we are both in both articles, so we're working together, not against each other.
Do you have try to compare these two works to see which one offers better results in terms of graphics?
I think that it depends on the input data that you have. If you use a 3D scan of a really more dense cloud, I think probably it would be easier or better to do it with circuit approach. But if you have a structure from motion, as you saw, the holes are completely covered thanks to the mesh. Because there's also a little bit of intelligence in the part of cleaning the mesh, because it's not just erasing every triangle, but it's not close to the original point cloud. It's also have to assume that there's a ground and there's a ceiling of a particular building, so nothing inside is normally removed, so all these holes are closed. So if you have a model with a lot of holes, I think it's better to do it this way.
Okay. Yes, please.
I saw a little bit of skies around the ceiling.
Yes.
I guess this depends on how you trim the.
Yes, it's
any idea how to improve this?
Yes. We are already working on this. We are trying to. Currently, we are working on two main things. One is to improve the mesh cleaning stage, because in this case, it's a tolerance value that it's when you're cleaning, you have to set a tolerance distance, because you don't want to make holes inside the mesh. But when you put it a little bit high, then you get a little bit of the sky. So we have to do another approach, but I think that would be not very difficult if you can segment the sky and detect when the sky is coming or something from the back or something like that.
The sky transparent?
Yeah, also that's a good idea.
Okay, thank you very much. The last paper of the session will be presented by Mr. Matatianakis. It's about 3D model screening. I know you can also introduce yourself to the audience.
Hello everybody, my name is Manuel Matatianakis, and I work for a multimedia group of Telecom Valitech in France. And today I'm going to present you the job that I'm doing with my colleagues Thierry Coccolato and Jean Lefebvre at synchronized delivery of 3D scenes with audio and video. This is the outline of my presentation. We will start by a brief overview of the current trends on 3D scene audio and video for the web. Then we will prepare a solution that I revealed already, which is packaging 3D scenes in MP4 files. We'll show you an example demo application. Then we will go through the tools we are using in order to achieve this, and specifically an algorithm for extracting XTD scenes we are using as an example from the MP4 files, and a trick we used in order to have similar 3D rendering for consecutive scenes inside the same scenario. So we've got a very widespread use of 3D scenes with audio and video. It's not yet to a daily experience for the average user, but we are getting there. This is due to evolutions in with HTML5, with some JavaScript APIs such as MSC and Web Audio, and of course WebGL, that was quite a huge step there. However, we don't have much work done in how the actual 3D scenes and audio and video are distributed. So the three dominant approaches is either we've got 3D scenes loaded statically with the web page, either hard-coded or that it's not important, AJAX, or having some generic compression packaging if you want to have all together, like a zip. What we propose is packaging the 3D scenes along with audio and video at the inside the M4 containers. So the M4 container has some logical tracks, and that usually we've got one track for video, one for audio, one for different audio or subtitles or stuff like that. So we are using tracks for 3D scenes, and every 3D scene is one save of a track, so we can have a stream of 3D scenes, in the sense that we can have multiple scenes alternating inside the same track with very tight synchronization, and it covers most common scenarios that we might want to do, since we can have also tracks for textures or non-time 3D scenes, but this is not the point here. I'm going to keep the same scene of an MP4 file as a reference, so we can see the benefits of it. We've got frame-accurate synchronization, because we are using the same mechanism for synchronization that they are used with audio and video, so we are pretty accurate on that. We can have alternative representations by using different tracks, so the user can be able to choose whatever he wants. Let's say, for example, that he might want to see a movie inside a 3D scene of a movie theater, can choose it from different movie theaters or stuff like that. It has, as it processes, by using several tracks or having non-time content. We've got streaming capabilities, as I explained to you before, by adding samples of different 3D scenes. We've got main delivery options, since we've got exactly the same delivery options we've got with MP4 files. We can stream them, dynamically download them however we want, even give them to a USB stick and still work. And most importantly, we don't lose the capability for the audio and video to be played by all the players that don't have 3D support. So even we can see, we've got a valid MP4 file, we can play that with any player that supports MP4 files. In order to achieve this, we need three tools. One tool for the actual packaging. We're working with a tool called JPack, which is a framework for multimedia content manipulation and packaging. So in order to do the actual packaging, we're using MP4 Box. It has natively XML support, in the sense that we are using some descriptors called NXML, which are also based in XML. So I'm specifically mentioning XML because we're going to stick with the XML-based 3D scenes throughout the presentation to keep a reference. And the MP4 files are completely valid, so they can be dashed. And then in order to extract the 3D scenes from the MP4 file, we're using MP4Box.js, which is a JavaScript library. Show information about the samples, the tracks, and timing information that are embedded inside the file in order for us to extract the scenes. And finally, we're using XFreedom in order to actually display the scene. For the packaging, this is the NHML descriptor that can be used in order to import the scenes inside the file. As you can see, we define a time scale, so we've got we can see how precise we want to be or not. We've got the media type meta, because it's considered to be generic metadata. There is not a specification for 3D scenes in MP4. Media sum type is Metix for XML-based format. We can use Metit for any format we want. And then we set the time that we want a sample to be available. In this case, we set DTS0, which means it's going to be from the start of the file. We don't set duration, so it's going to be until the next sample. We specified that it's going to be a random access point, so if the user wants to seek inside the video file, the 3D scene will still be there. And then the name of the X3D file. This is some screenshots, not something fancy, because I wanted to emphasize on the concept. So on the left of the screen you see the Big Bad Bunny after a playback of 5 or 6 seconds, and then afterwards we have loaded a different scene which is contained inside the same file. And this is how it works on the client side. It's a very rough outline, but we've got the MP4 file that it's loaded inside the Dvbox.js, our library. Then we can extract the X3D scene and the AV content. The AV content is deployed using media source extensions. For the X3D scene, even though it's packaged without any modifications, afterwards what we it has to pass from a ULP processor, because we want to be able to use X3D files that already exist and not having to rewrite the content, but we will see in some details later. Then it's passed to X3 DOM and it's displayed on the inside the browser. This is a pseudocode for how we can use MP4.js. So we analyze the file, then we check each track to see if it's video, audio, or X3D. In case it's, and we initialize the respective elements inside the web page, so we will be able to have the content. Then for each sample that arrives, if it's X3D, which means it's a full X3D scene, we iterate throughout the nodes in order to find one that has a video texture pointing to the same file, and we redirect the redirect the texture to the actual track. So this is done, so we will not have to edit neither the MP4 files, the audio video content of the files, nor the X3D. So we can take all 3D scenes and add them inside the video, and with this simple preprocessing, by checking just the name of the video file and the name of the texture, we can actually send it to the specific track that contains the video frames, so we'll not have to alter it during packaging. And then it's just the rendering and synchronization, which is the same as video. This is a simple trick we did in order to have a relatively seamless 3D scene playback. So we start parsing the MP4 file. It's a process that does not take a lot of time, but it does take time. And we get notified that we have a 3D scene. So we start setting up the content. We get notified that we've got video. We start setting up the context. And as soon as both are ready, we start the playback. So we can have synchronization from 0 seconds. And then when we get notified about the second consecutive 3D scene, we start preparing the content before it's time to actually display it. We initialize the canvas, we keep it invisible, and when it's the time to switch, we actually turn invisible the first canvas, activate the, turn visible the second one, and destroy the first in the background in order to have the scene. And this is what we do for the actual simple cube and cylinder scenario that I showed you before. And we are actually currently working for more complex scenarios. More specifically, we are focused on two areas. The first is with not for X3D files, but other formats like a BIF that support animations. So we can have one track containing the baseline BIF and the second track the time animation, so we will be able to update the scene during runtime. And finally, we are trying to find solutions in order to have seamless playback in more complex scenarios. We didn't actually consider it for this presentation, since I wanted to emphasize on the benefits we have with the MP4 file, and not the actual not the actual display of complex 3D scenes. And I tried to keep it short, so you will not be hungry. If you want, you can contact us with this email pattern. The tools we are using are free and open source, so you can feel free to check them out. And we will probably have a demo also working with a simple scene by next week or something like that. Thank you for your time.
Any questions, please?
Are there any patents associated with these techniques?
The patents are the same as the MBEX files, in the sense that MBEX standardization board depends, because you've got the encoding of the video, so you might have patents in the encoding of the video, or it's very generic to say just a yes or no answer. So it really depends on what else you've got inside the container.
The downloading of the X3DOM file takes place within the endpoint for file, or it is outside the container?
No, no, everything is one single file in the endpoint. It's exactly the same thing as we do with the video. So we can have, or with the audio, we can have two languages inside the same MP4 file, and we choose the language we want, so we can choose the 3D scene we want. We don't have anything outside the MP4 container.
So it is one X3DOM file downloaded from the client. It is not segmented into parts.
No, it's not segmented in parts. We have consideration for segmented, but since X3D doesn't support something like that, I didn't mention it at all.
Because you said something about DAS, this is why I asked that.
Yes, we can segment files, but we don't do it with X3D because it doesn't support it, but we can do it.
Okay, and then you use the scene descriptor of the MP4 file to synchronize.
Yes, the synchronization is actually pretty straightforward because we've got, we don't have such tight notions of timing inside the X3D. So the synchronization is, we have to just choose the video frame we want to assign to. So it's very accurate and simple to do.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.